Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Intel Extreme Masters Cologne, where no one is ever late to the party, are they, Sean?
No. Are all the semi-finalists there?
Yes.
Are you here?
I'm here.
Good.
Are you here?
Yeah.
Good job. Quarterfinals were fun, weren't they?
Yeah, really fun, but super one-sided as well in that last one, wasn't it?
Yeah, a bit. I mean, because the first three we were kind of spoilt, weren't we? Because there were some awesome games, some great comebacks from J-Dong, PVTs were epic, and then the last one was a bit of a Artosis bop.
Yeah, it was a little bit unfortunate there. There's a lot of discussion going back and forth between Protoss players and Terran players on if it's Protoss that's, you know, dominant right now, if Terran can do better. But whatever the case, it was a 3-0. But even, I mean, whichever way we look at it, Hero's a great player. He's going to do really well. And I think he's going to do very well in the semi-final as well.
Yeah, let's have a quick look at the brackets and update you as to if you've just come in and joined us for the Intel Extreme Masters. Where the heck have you been? Because that's not very cool of you. But don't worry, got your backs because I've got all the results for you. So hopefully we can bring the bracket up in a moment and show you all of the quarterfinal results and how all of these players got through to semi-finals. Poulton Rain is our first matchup in the semi-final. And then J-Dong takes on Hero. So we'll concentrate on Poult versus Rain. To start with, Rain has dropped a sum total of one map at the whole of the Intel Extreme Masters ever.
Ever.
Well, over the last 4 days. Yeah. And he has looked, I mean, apart from the birthday gift of one map to his friend Jack G on his birthday, he has looked flawless. I mean, I called him Rain the Robot earlier because he's literally like an automaton. He just seems to go, yeah. I'm doing this, and this. And he's super silky smooth with his Protoss play as well.
I think one of the best
never looks
things,
fast.
The best things about Rain is that, so all the rage recently is a Blink play, Dark Templar play, Oracle play, but the way that Rain made his name was off straight up standard games. So the ability to be able to do both excellently, and he showed that against Jack Chi. One time it's a blink all in, the next time it's a very regular style of play. So he's a very dangerous opponent, and I would go as far as say is he's almost as double dangerous as Classic was against Poult earlier.
Do you think he, I mean, we've had periods of dominance in StarCraft 2, but nothing that's really lasted massively long, especially in Heart of the Swarm anyway. We had Innovation kind of WCS Season 1, cool. And then Season 2, well, Bomber ended up winning that. But there was also a lot of stuff around Poult doing well, J-Don coming back to form. Season 3, suddenly Deer comes out of nowhere. I think he was like 2,278th on the WCS Challenger list the month before. Yeah. Comes out of nowhere and dominates. And then we haven't had periods of domination by any one player. But Rain seems to be the man, I think anyway, that we could see him dominate for a little while.
Yeah, definitely, especially as just a Protoss player himself. There's not too many people that you can say that, yeah, I think someone else is a better Protoss player. Rain has always been up there as top three Protoss player, no matter which way you look at it. Sure, he loses some games here and there, but he immediately bounces back. When it comes to consistency, definitely up there as a top Protoss player. Consistency internationally, welcome to 2014.
Yeah, I mean, it's great to see him outside of Korea. Great to see him come and compete at the Intel Extreme Masters. I asked Hero a little cheekily earlier, is he thinking about Katowice? And he kind of, you know, he was like, oh, I thought it was points. And then I found out I had to come and, you know, win this tournament. Oh, well, come and win the tournament then. Rain is in a similar sort of position because he found out quite late and he was like, oh, so I have to finish top two and then I go, oh, well, that's easy. I'll come along to Cologne then. No problem at all. But it's great to see him outside of Pro League. It's great to see him in Europe as well. If he wins this, and he is the favourite still, do we see him more often, do you think, outside of Korea? Or do you think this is just a focus on the World Final for now at Katowice?
I think more so for a lot of these Pro League players, they're restricted a lot by their teams. And I think that the team's overall main focus is Pro League. It's a Korean, just a Korean ethical thing that they want to win Pro League. That's what they've been built around for over the years. But when something comes along where you can win $100,000, why wouldn't you want to send out a player? Whether we'll see Rain travel on SKT to come out to international tournaments to win a $25,000 tournament, 10,000 first place, I'm not sure if they'll want to bring him away from Pro League to do that. But for this, and if there's any other tournaments along similar lines, then I think, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, let's move on from Rain and talk a little bit about Poult first. Hearing him where we do have a little bit of time, so that's good. He's like, I always want to crown him King of the Terrans right now because he seems to be one of the few, not the only, but one of the few who is able to figure out a Blink Stalker's all in, which he definitely seems to have figured out, and he seems to be able to cope with almost any Blink play. Seems relatively, I mean, he said it himself, I'm pretty comfortable with it, I'm okay with it. And I definitely am not comfortable with it, and I don't know many Terrans that would actually own up to saying, yeah, Blink all in's no problem.
Yeah, why? He does.
I mean, how is he like that? And I mean, effectively what we're saying here is it the Terran Protoss thing again, or is it actually Polt just going, doesn't exist, I'm just going to do what I think is right, and I'm going to be offensive instead of just sitting back and building barracks all the time?
He has a couple of tricks. On Yondu, we've seen his tricks come out a couple of times, and I'm sure that he doesn't feel that bad on the map. I actually managed to speak to him earlier. He said, Yondu, yeah, it can be difficult, but I've managed to pull tricks out, and I'm still comfortable on that map against it. The other big map is Heavy Rain, where he said it's 50-50. Sometimes it goes well for him, sometimes it doesn't, which we've actually seen in the tournament itself. And then the worst map for him is Daedalus Point, which he vetoes out usually against Blink players. But the thing is, I spoke to him as well coming up into the game against Rain, is he's not that worried against Blink play because it's Rain. Classic, someone completely different who was not afraid to use these type of plays. But Rain, on the other hand, the side of thing, that isn't his normal game sense. So Paul actually said, as much as I was scared of Classic, there is a bit of comfort knowing that I'm going to play a more standard game. And when he does play these standard games, we've seen him absolutely shine.
Yeah, a long macro game much more suits him, and he's more likely to get that against Rain, but he's already beaten Classic, who was potentially, for him anyway, the harder player. Just one last thing with Polt, and I'm looking ahead a little bit, and maybe just speculating, but the problem with his map choices is if he gets to the final, it's best of seven. And he's not good on three of the four of the seven maps. That's not good, right?
I'm pretty sure Polt, knowing his previous results, is wishing Jadon can beat Hero.
And on that note, we'll end our discussions, I think. That second semi-final is coming up straight after this one. Don't forget, you can still vote on the MVP award, of course, over on facebook.com/IEM. I must apologise as well, because I'm doing a lot of that lately. I did say that you could vote on anyone. There is actually a poll up with a list of the players in the poll. You can only vote on those ones. But do so now, or do so before the end of the second semi-final, because if you don't do that, you won't get a vote. We will be announcing the winner of the MVP, the Sickner Baller of Cologne, just before the grand final. Time now to go for our first semi-final of the day. The winner of this not only gets into the grand final here in Cologne, but guarantees a spot in the winner-takes-all $100,000 World Championship final. That's what's on the line right now. It's time to go over to your commentary team. Enjoy your semi-final. This one's going to be a cracker, I can feel it. It's Rain versus Polt.
Thanks very much. All right. Well, our first round of four series now on the way. A cracker, man. An absolute cracker. Fireworks are going to go off. We're going to have those Catherine wheels spinning around and everything. This is going to be crazy as we have Polt versus Rain. Two players that are dispatched of their previous, say, opponents that were the same race. Very, very well. It was close. It was a close call. All the games were close calls apart from that last one. But now we have Polt versus Rain. I'm looking forward to this, Todd.
Yeah, me too. Polt, in this tournament, he's had a lot more versus Protoss games, which as much as Rain probably watched those, and I'm sure he did when I say probably, he's had a lot more warm-up, basically, versus the race. Then again, a lot of the time, you're not going to be happy as a pro gamer just because you reveal more of your builds. But it really felt like Polt, he was that guy who has his one go-to builds. He goes back to a lot, which was the expansion with the reactor and then two additional barracks being added on and lots of bioforces. So on the other hand, you have Polt that has been playing this style. And on the other hand, you have Rain that has played a single best of five versus Terran versus Jack G, in which his go-to build has actually been the exact same in both games that he used to win with it, which was the Colossus plus Blink into a third base, even if it's late, he doesn't care. Yep. He gets enough probes, he makes sure he gets it up, he makes sure he doesn't die and doesn't take any damage from those medivac drops. At which point, he just seems unstoppable. He defends everything. He's like the Jadon version of Protoss. Anything you throw at him, he's going to be ready and defend with this Colossi and a good Blink play.
Yeah.
So this is going to be basically the build of Polt versus the build of Rain here for me, in my opinion. Offense versus defense a lot of the time. I'm sure Polt is going to try to do the same thing he did before with the army split up in half a lot of the time to try and attack left and right, to try spread his open thin. But he's up against the best Protoss defender in the world.
Yes.
Maybe after Hazuops, but probably ahead.
Well, I mean, now, right now, since November, he's 23-2 in maps against Terran is Rain.
Not bad.
Yeah, and considering a lot of casters, we do use this term quite often. It's like, if anybody can do it, it's this guy. But it actually is Polt. It actually is Polt. If anybody can beat Rain, it's this guy. Because he has some of the best TVP in the world right now. He's shown us it throughout this tournament. And it looks absolutely blistering. But still, going up against a player like Rain, who plays so stable, so strong. Polt's best friend is going to be the scan and trying to catch hold of those observers.
Rain has shown that he does not always play the same style, though. He's used some nice blink play himself. And with the recent success of Hero vs. Innovation here, who played more of a standard Protoss versus standard, where you try to trick your opponent from early on with some one base or two base play, and from there you increase your lead early on, and you're able to go into a macro game with an advantage. Mm-hmm. Rain could choose to play a little bit differently, at least more often than before. Before, it really felt like it was like 3 games out of 4 he will go for his go-to build, at least 2 games out of 3. But if he was to play very differently here, Apollo did mention that Polt was not really expecting any kind of very aggressive blink play here out of him. And I didn't pay attention if he had removed Daedalus, actually, versus Rain, which he did mention is the one map he wouldn't feel very comfortable against most Protosses with, because of that blink play.
Well, we'll find out in a bit. Frost is our first map here, as we have now Polt on screen. And as we said before, his TVP is super, super strong. We've seen it throughout this tournament, looking fantastic. And then we have arguably one of the favorites of the tournament. It's Rain.
This is my wish list, man. I want to see Rain's build versus Polt's build right away in the first map here on
Just
Frost.
Just the standard versus the standard, and then we have one
7
of the best games
of it.
Yeah. That would be fantastic.
Actually, it's a best of 5, but I'm getting a little bit ahead.
You can have an extra 2 if you really want. I mean, you can just ask them to keep playing, and it's like, wait a minute, we're behind schedule, guys. Let's wrap this up quickly. But no, Polt is going to be going on to this map. He's actually taking his time getting into this lobby here, just contemplating his thoughts, I guess, and you know, making sure that he's stable as he faces. It's like in the round of 8. He had to play against Classic, which was level 1 of SKT Protosses. And now he has to play against level 10 of SKT Protosses because Rain's massive.
What's Parting's level then?
8 or 9.
If he's listening right now, he's hating
you. I mean 11. I mean, no, Parting. Oh. Long story short, they have really, really good Protoss.
Yeah, but this is such a strain, too, to have such good Protosses on your team. When you have to prepare for a match like this, you can consult them. They're going to give you advice. You can choose to listen to it or not. And that's going to be the question here, too. Because Rain, he has his own style, which is the best at the Colossus plus Blink play. And this is just... When you have a best build, it's really hard to basically change your mind and start using different stuff just because you're so good at it. It's not only that he's the best at this build, it's also that it's his best build by far, in my opinion.
It is.
But then again, he showed us he can use different play and pull it off quite successfully. But now against Polt, would it be enough if he went for something like some blink play?
Well, let us also remember here that between these two players, the winner gets a spot guaranteed at the Intel Extreme Masters Katowice. A spot with the other 15 players to compete for $100,000 as first place. That's a big deal. They've already bagged themselves a good chunk of prize pool when it comes to this tournament, and already a nice chunk of WCS points. But if you, in the grand scheme of the Intel Extreme Masters, that Katowice position, participating in that tournament alone is a fantastic thing. They've already got 2,000 guaranteed here. They've already got 375 points guaranteed here. And it's all about that grand final at the very end.
Qualifying for Katowice surely should help in getting some more of those points too.
I think so, probably. I certainly do think so. As it's such a big prize pool that I think it qualifies for a Tier 1 tournament. This is currently Tier 2. The system was changed since 2013, so there was Tier 1s and Tier 2s, the Tier 1 being the biggest one, which was like $25,000 prize pools and up or whatever, or $20,000 and up.
But to be honest, these two players, with their current skill and shape, they probably want more than just points as well.
Oh, yeah.
$100,000, that's points in the bank.
Yeah, it really, I mean, the lineup's fantastic that we already see at Katowice, but with one of these guys added to it, then, oh my God. I mean, we had a fantastic lineup here, but Katowice is going to be amazing. Anyway, let's get into this round of four series. It's all about these two players, Rain versus Polt. One of them will advance on to the grand final. We have spawning up to the top right-hand corner, our red Protoss, representing SK Telecom T1. It is Rain. Down to the bottom left, the perfect spawning positions for our first game. Representing CM Storm, it's Polt. All right, man.
Gonna be keeping a very close eye on both players' build order, especially after that initial opener, which I expect is gonna be a commencer in the Nexus. I wanna see that Robo Forge against the three barracks, man.
Yeah.
And on this map, actually, it's gonna be different than what we saw Polt do on Yeonsu, where he was taking one watchtower with the Reaper, the other one with Bioforces. Even though, if he did that, I guess, against Rain, it could be okay, because Rain not really been very aggressive, as mentioned, but it would be, if he gets caught off guard, it would be pretty bad. I actually think that Rain's style versus Polt here in this series, he might have a bit of an advantage if they were to do their builds.
I think also it's interesting to note here that right now, since we have Barracks opener against Gateway opener, neither player's being too risky about like going for a Nexus first, going for a Command Center first, which is very interesting considering how the overarching structure of this best of five is going to work. Yeah. So neither player wants to take too much risk early on. They want to play it as stable as possible.
This is, actually, I wanted to develop a little bit more, but I saw you really wanted to talk. So, coming back to these two players' main builds, Paul gets a lot of bio forces on three barracks. I think mostly because he wants to be able to hold comfortably against Oracles, against Blink Stalker play, and all these things. But against Rain, how well would it do? We saw Rain before getting his Colossus on time to be able to defend against lots of bio forces. So, that's why I would give him a slight edge. If Paul was going for this, and didn't do any damage to Rain, you will fall behind because he's taking a little bit later, whereas Rain is taking fairly quickly. He gets the Forge, he gets the Colossus, he gets the Blink very quickly. So it's going to be a bit weird and awkward if they go for it at the same time, because Rain's build is really designed to defend a standard build where your opponent gets medivacs and start dropping from very early on two bases while taking a third. Whereas Paul's build is designed to counter the more standard Protoss play.
Yeah.
When you to go for the Blink Stalkers and all that. So this could get weird here, and we might find ourselves in situations we've never been in before, which I'm most looking forward to.
Well, we have the React being added on that Barracks. And, you know, the one thing that's very evident about Rain's style in general is that Paul is really not anticipating something like Hero did on this map against Innovation, for example, which is that proxy pile on everywhere elsewhere with the Twilight Council that we've seen quite a few times now in recent history, not only at Sao Paulo, but also through the qualifiers into Katowice, and now here at this tournament as well. So there's certainly a lot of options open to Protoss, but Rain, stable as ever, going straight to his build. I'm waiting for that Forge and Robo, waiting for it.
And I really like the way he gets the three Stalkers. I mentioned that before. That's definitely going to help against what Polt might do too, with getting in a lot of Marines and try to pressure. Possibly you see he's getting a second Stalker already, just as the first one finished. And there goes the Robo.
Yay.
Polt's mixing it up.
Ooh.
And this is, I think, I like it.
What?
You know, I just mentioned that if Polt did his regular build here against Rain, I thought he'd be behind, just because the way everything will turn out.
Yeah.
I don't know for sure. I'm just theory crafting here a little bit, so bear with me. If you get a lot of bio forces and your opponent gets a quick Colossus, you're going to be in trouble. It's just not going to be good for you. Nothing. You're not going to be able to make anything happen. Now, getting the quick factory here, this could mean a number of things, but we've seen Rain before able to defend very, very well against a very quick Widowmine drop. So I expect nothing else here but good defense from him if this was to happen again.
And if you're just tuning in now here for the round of four, guys, Polt all tournament long has had to go up against Protoss, and every single game it's been three Barracks opener, certainly not to the factory early. So this is certainly that deviation up that you are mentioning. And we're going to see how it's going to play out here. This is cool to see from Polt, the fact that he can play this this alternate style.
Polt's a genius, man. He can definitely do more than one thing.
He can do what he wants.
Even though, just like Rain, they are very similar in a way. They have their go-to build, mm-hmm. and they can do other things very, very well, both of them. In this case, Rain's going to stick to his usual style and that Reaper, trying to get in the main, and he's going to see exactly what he was probably expecting.
Exactly, yeah.
With the Robo and the Forge. And Rain not going to try to trick Pult as opposed to Pult, changing things up. Rain's just going for his standard Robo Bay. Remember what follows? The Twilight Council very quickly after that, usually. And we have a very quick Medivac here on the way, so that aggression here, we've seen Rain hold it very, very well before. Is it going to do any damage this time?
Those two Widow Mines going to be picked up and good to go, jet setting away. Once again, here as our observers are moving out into the middle of the map. It's just observers from here on out. He already has three. It really has begun. He's going to keep an eye on everything. He truly is the Eye of Sauron. It has like three out already. Fourth one's on the way. Probably going to be Chrono Boosted. I haven't checked the. No, he hasn't. He isn't actually Chrono Boosting it, but he already sees what's on his way. So this is good for Rain, at least.
Yeah, and very quick third here by Pult, by the way, around the 8 minutes. Well, remember before when Jack D tried that on Habitation Station, it was actually at the gold, and he ended up getting attacked and having to evacuate and lost quite some SCVs. So Paul's going to have to be careful not to end up in a similar scenario. But actually, does he know that this Medivac is headed for his main? He has the Mothership Core in position to get a good photon overcharge, but the cannon is not finished.
It's about two, and just a second, he forces the lift off and goes out. Photon Overcharge does push that away. Meanwhile, second Photon Overcharge trying to deal with these Marines. They get themselves a pylon, but that's about it.
So Paul forced the double Photon Overcharge here, and then he's going to pull back. Most likely going to lose all of these Marines. This is why these three Stalkers are so... Oh, nice!
Ooh, zoning out.
To basically save his Marines here. He needs to pick everything up and leave, possibly.
Yeah, he had two options. He could have done that and tried to save some, or he could have just picked them up and ran away, which is either one would have worked out similarly, as we have extra gateways being added on for Rain here.
Yeah, but as he was able to force the double photon recharge and didn't do any damage, this means that Rain's not going to have another photon recharge for quite some time now. And when the mid-game Medivac drops will begin, it's going to be very, very good for Pult, because there is not going to be that extra defensive option. And he's demining the field, and this is going to mean he might take a very late third here if Pult really tries to delay it.
Well, also, Rain spotted his opponent's third pretty quickly after it went down, so he knows kind of roughly the area he's in right now. Thermal Lance is on the way, as well as that first Colossus, and that Nexus will end up going down in the middle of the map. And look at all of this production being added on from Pult here. Really going for that macro focus, really looking to ramp up that production so strongly.
Still no armory, though. And remember what we've seen before. We've seen big SCV pulls against Colossus play, but actually Rain, very, very good in defense against it in the past versus Jack G in the final map. Nice missile turret in the main, by the way, of Pult. I really like the placement on that one in bottom right-hand side of his main base, making sure that if a warpism gets in there, this is going to help. And macro-wise right now, Pult is really on top of things. He's made so many barracks, he's going to have a great production capability. He's getting a whole bunch of Vikings. Still no Amori. Combat Shield's about to finish. Oh, there it is.
Okay.
It actually starts it quite late, but I guess he was getting plus one attack fairly late because of his build. Because he went for the factory, the starport, and then added on two extra barracks.
Yeah, and he's built a really strong barrier of vision around his bases as well here as Rain. So once again, the Observer's keeping an eye on everything, as well as a pylon up to the north. To just keep an eye on what was going on. And losing this factory, he won't be able to make any start ports. But he started that second starport just at the right time here. So that was good by Pult.
I actually wonder if Pult's going to start scanning for observers. Before versus Patience, he knew that, well, why did he just team everything? Well, he thought he was getting chased down. Is this a misclick? Or is this a mistake? Or did he mean to do that? This is a bit weird.
A little bit. He can heal up, though, and just rest on for now.
I really think that if Pult does not scan for these observers, did he just team again? I think he did. Oh, he's using a lot of the energy on his medivacs.
Yeah. Well,
I really think that if Pult does not scan ever for these observers, it's going to be very, very hard for him to win. It's basically going to be an SCV pull and an attack or nothing.
He stims again. He's really wary of any high Templar numbers that would be out. He knows his opponent is guaranteed to have defenses. He's too good to not have the defenses available to him.
This is super interesting.
Yeah, it's a good technique. It's a really good technique.
Charge on the way. 2-2 is going to start. We've seen actually a timing really missing Rain's weak point when doing this strategy with 2-2 finishing before when Anolin was headed his way. But remember that last game. versus Jack G. Tutu did not finish on time. It was really the positioning and the micro of rain that allowed him to hold. And now we have a pot on 184 supply against 149.
Jeez, the macro just absolutely exploded for him. 119 army supply against 79. Yeah. Very much in favor of pot if he wanted to try and do something with it. But at the same time, that's a lot of firepower that those yes. Colossi possess.
Sensor Tower is on the way. Three Vikings are being made at the time. And with the Ghost Academy already made, this is actually a fairly passive game from both players. Polt wants to beat Rain at his own game here. He's playing safe and standard, I guess, up to some extent.
I think we might be in for this in for the long haul here, Todd.
Tempest?
That's a very, very long haul, but we'll find out as we now have four medevacs loading up, good to go up to the... No, that's the wrong way, that's the wrong way, that's
oh
the wrong
my.
Way.
Ooh. Rain actually not reacting to this. He could have sniped one more, I think.
Yeah.
And you know, he just selected his stalkers.
He's like, wait,
like, well, what's happened? He's like, doesn't even know.
He like clicks on one of them. It's like, oh, I've got one kill, sick. I don't know how. a really nice, well executed yeah. snipe out there by Rain. Anyway, okay, so for now he's gonna actually move up here once again, but he gets spotted.
Yeah, 2-2 is gonna finish. Plus two attack already finished here, and actually. Not any units in position in the main. He sees that big drop coming with three medivacs. He gets three Templars and a few Zealots.
Which
the Colossus that just came out is in position as well to help. Oh. Feedbacks!
If he had like a few Stalkers on the edge of that, they would have been brutalized, but...
Go home, medivacs. You're drunk.
Poor little fellas. He drops the scan. He's like, hey, I knew there was an Observer here. at the very end. So,
War Prism by Rain here, so he might try and go for some harassment with some nice Zealot drops and Warpins, possibly. I'm actually surprised those medivacs are still where they're at with so little hit points. Should definitely go back and repair them, possibly land a mule and repair them. That'd
be
a good
nice.
Idea.
Yeah.
3-3 started for Rain and a Stargate.
Whoa.
This has been a very passive game where he's almost maxed out. The Stargate now means he's already thinking about transitioning into Tempest. We could be seeing a very, very long game here.
We could be. And the thing is also that War Prism going down to the bottom right-hand corner. Yes, it can bounce between those two locations, but that one missile turret you pointed out earlier is very, very important. I'm surprised that Paul's going to go for an engagement, but maybe he just wants to trade off. He knows he has a bit of a bank set up here, so he can actually trade a little bit. And he's actually pushing away and kills off. Well,
oh,
and nice, that's fourth base.
Paul killed that fourth base.
Mm.
So he's delaying the force base here. That's all he wants to do. He does not really want to take a fight, even though it took like so for a second.
That's so vulnerable. It's like watching Jadong play against Patience just before putting his tech at the front of one of these vulnerable bases and positions. And now Polt here actually breaks on through. Behind
what?
This, he's got a load of command centers going down as well. This is going to certainly go on. A Raven. I love the Raven.
Yeah.
Ah. Oh.
He's getting personal cloaking as well. 3-3 started for Polt. I really think he's going to stay on a low SCV count, which actually 66. This is quite ideal. Maybe later on he can go to even less when he has more orbital commands.
But the Raven's cool because, you know, he knows his opponent always plays very observer heavy. He has killed off quite a few of them, but there's always going to be that replenishment eventually for him.
This chunk of units here needs to pull back. And the Planetary Fortress here is going to help, but is there enough for Ports, who's got quite a few medivacs across the map, three medivacs filled with units, looking for a cancel on that force base. They should be able to get it too.
Rain doesn't realize the entire army isn't there, though. This is a big important note here as Paul drops up to the north and will look to pressure on, but Rain already knows. Rain is pulling back. He had something that spotted it up to the top left-hand corner.
He had some Zealots. This is actually weird. Like usually you see this from Marines or Zerglings, but not Zealots, and this definitely saved this fourth base here. I really thought this was going to be a cancel. Paul's going around the map with another chunk of unit. He wants to snipe.
It's
the Nexus Sniper, man.
Yeah, it's Paul time. He's splitting his army up into two large chunks, and then from there, he's going to keep Rain dancing forever and ever. Plus 3-3 is now just about to finish, though, for him. Nice Storm on this top left-hand corner. That's the one disadvantage that you see normally here from Paul, as he will get hit by Storms.
Tempest.
Three at a time, and they're getting weapons upgrades as well here, Todd. This is going to have a lot of firepower behind it eventually, but it's going to take a while.
This is going to be super tricky for both players to make this work too, because I'm sure they don't have that much experience with this. A lot of players theory crafted about this. I'm sure everybody has had a few games here and there where this happened, where you are in basically a very late game situation where you have Tempests up against possibly a lot of Vikings, sometimes some Battle Cruisers, sometimes some Ravens. QXE actually won't say that mass Battle Cruisers plus Ravens was unbeatable, an unbeatable Terran army, even if you have Tempest.
He said it was good against Tempest because the PDDs actually soak up the shots of the Tempest, which is quite nice. So Storm does hit up to the top left, and he will push that away with Zealots in the end. But this is going to continue on for longer. That's a lot of ghosts he actually has out on the field right now. They haven't done anything just yet, but they certainly will do eventually. Oh!
Bolt is starting to expand like a madman.
Yeah, basically.
They're actually
everywhere.
Expanding right next to each other. This is.
There's
an observer just right above this army here.
Yeah, he's going to keep an eye on him.
I'm a little bit surprised that Rain does not try to intercept these attacks, but I guess he's afraid to get attacked on another side. And look, he's left a whole bunch of Templars
His
force base plus cannons to be ready for some kind of counterattack.
Nice Storm at the front, and you can... Oh, he's sacrificing a few SCVs.
It has started. It has begun.
It has begun. He's just going to sacrifice a few of those off so his army can be even stronger, even bigger. Maybe not even faster, but he will have +3 weapons finish up for his Vikings as well.
Paul is on 6 orbitals right now. He's up to 61 SCVs. Could even go lower than this, and actually just going to PF on that bottom right hand
side.
He's
like a Zerg. He's expanded up to the top left and the top right, bottom right even. That's pretty sick.
This is not very orderly.
Well.
All those Tempests. In the face of very few Marines and Marauders, they should be able to do fine against this. And more Sensor Tower being made. Another one.
A lot of upgrades about to finish in here. He's actually going to drop in the natural. This is a pretty good spot to drop in. It has a little bit of infrastructure on it. He also notices exactly what he's going to be going up against, and he will bring down that Nexus.
Ooh, Templar
so
is coming this way.
And that does end up falling. The Storm only hits like 4 Marines in the very end. That's a better Storm, though. The second one, and on the top left-hand corner as well. Paul pushing forwards with a few... does get stormed, will get shut down. Cannons and high Templar defenses in even small numbers. Oh, what a great blink forwards. Can really hold on very, very nicely against these bio pushes.
Actually, Rain has fell to 42 probes here against 60 SCVs. So he's going to have a quite strong army if he maxes out, which it looks like... he's doing right now. Yeah. He's getting a lot of Archons. I think he's going to go for a big attack.
He has the gas available to him.
He's fell behind at his own game here. A passive game early on, a very economic game, and he might go for a huge attack because he's either on tilt or he thinks he cannot win otherwise.
Now, we will probably see PDD go down for that Raven to guard against those Tempests so that when the Vikings fly in, he's going to try and push and kill those as quickly as he can do. And then if he doesn't actually have that much anti-air aside from those. Yes, Storms, the Vikings will clump up, obviously. But this is going to be a great engagement once they end up coming along.
And Bolt is doing this so well. He knows that the weakness of that army of Rain with the Tempest is probably the lack of mobility. Oh, those Templars!
Oh, get caught off guard there. 2 go down for just a small bio force and a lot of Storms soaked up from those. And those 2 Stalkers doing all right, shutting down that base up to the top left. But Paul can just drop mules wherever he wants on either side of the map, and he'll be doing all right. Although Rain finds one of these bases.
Gravitic Boosters is being made right now, as well as 2 extra observers. Even though Rain has 3 with his army, he wants more vision.
Personal cloaking is a very important tool here for Paul if those observers do end up going down. But Rain realizes that the PDD soaking up some of the shots from that. Those Tempests as he tries to break the planetary fortress, but he doesn't even break that. Never mind the entire army.
Pretty good EMPs are going to force Rain back, and in the meantime, he's being attacked on the right hand side. Paul's going to move somewhere else with his medivacs and drop into the natural again. This could get sniped.
A great game so far as Paul tries to hit multiple locations at the same time. Doing pretty well at the natural once again. Pushing on forwards, killing off a few of these high Templars, but they get all of the medivacs. No retreat out for this bio force. They're just going to have to trade against those Zealots. And he's actually chasing away the medivacs up to the top right. They need to go and do some damage somewhere.
You know, as well as Paul is doing this right now, he's missing 2 dozen barracks. He's on 6 bases, 7. Some of those are not mining, but he only has 8 barracks. What's his plan here? He needs way more barracks than this. He needs to add a lot more. He has a huge bank right now.
He got a few of those high Templars to feed back the medivacs up to the top right. A nice snipe out there for him. Right now, Rain's army is 140 supply against 125. It's so strong, it's comprised almost entirely of high-powered units. But he feels as if he has to pull on back for a second.
Look at the army value.
Wow.
7,150. Actually, 7,000. 7,400 against 6,600, but this Colossi Tempest composition, what does the Vikings attack? The tricky part is going to be dodging the storms too.
Yeah.
It's like those PVZ situations where you have a lot of corruptors coming in, they get stormed, they die very quickly. It's going to be tricky to be able to spread them out and get the good EMPs and snipe that Bolt is going to need without losing his Ghost up front, because we have a lot of Tempest and Colossi that shoots from very far.
But to exactly what you're saying, Bolt realizes that he might need to replenish his Vikings extremely quickly, so he's adding on an extra star port so that he can actually go for that. Tries to cloak forwards and get a few EMPs off, hits two of those High Templars in the end and drains half of their energy, but needs to drain a little bit more. The Storms will fall, and that PDD soaking up a lot of the shots there, protecting these Vikings.
Oh, the Vikings took quite some damage. Bolt needs to be careful. This is the best way to walk into a storm to chase like this.
There's the splits and the pursuit for Polt continues on. If he can get on top of some of this army, he's going to be okay. But those Archons, if they get under the Vikings, they could do quite a lot of AoE damage, but they're still split. A few of the storms on the bottom right-hand side here kill off a lot of those Vikings very, very quickly. But at the same time, a lot of Rain's army is also melting. Can Polt replenish now? Because Rain is able to survive with much, much more of it, and he's going to march on. Can Polt macro up hard enough to be able to deal with this?
He can replenish, but not nearly as fast as his opponents. He's on, we have 10 gateways for Rain, which is actually quite low for being a Protoss player at this point in the game. 8 barracks still for Bolt. This is not enough to remake his army very quickly.
And lost a little bit there to those Dark Templars. The Zealots also charge on forwards as well, but meanwhile he's going to hit this planetary fortress, this fortified location. The SCVs come off the line. He really wants to defend that location, but he's not able to, as Rain now powers on once again. If he can just lay claim to this ground here, it might be all right, but again, Pulse holding on with that macro pressure.
Oh, these Templars, they're ready for some storms.
They have the energy. There's no ghosts to be able to deal with them, and the storms continue to rain on down from the Protoss player as he pushes Pulse back once again here. But there is the Mule Hammer bringing in that luscious, luscious gold. He's going to actually blink forwards. Catches a few of those Vikings once again. Rain, with this army composition, is 86 supply against 71, and he constantly is really, really bringing it to Polt. Polt can't really do too much against this. He doesn't have the ability to add on the precious units that he needs. He needs ghosts to be with this army, but he's only ever replenishing with Marauders and Marines. He knows he needs units very quickly, but it's not going to be enough. Rain is making this work.
Yeah, he is right now. 76 army supply to 56. 46 probes to 28. Paul's going to have to evacuate his base here, and this...
Run away!
This is looking quite bad right now. Even though he has a lot of mules on the bottom right-hand side, he has so many
Jeez,
mules.
What's his income at?
This is not going to last.
No, it's not. And also, he doesn't really have
too
much gas.
I don't think he's going to get it, but nice attempt here. Forced to big warp in from his opponents.
Certainly ambitious. There is one High Templar there for a storm, and it will end up catching quite a lot of that bio. And the Zealots and Dark Templars should be able to push that away.
This is what we've seen very often. The 10 basically does not have the sufficient economy anymore to get a lot of ghosts out, which he needs oh so much in those fights. And Paul, this is going to be so hard for him to win this game. Not having ghosts against this Archon army, Colossus, Templars.
It's like, if you, after the performance that we've seen from Paul in this game, if you can't break Rain like this, how do you break him? Rain just continues on, despite not having the most amazing economy behind this. His army is so formidable that every trade that gets entered into, it's very even army supplies, but the quality of Rain's army is so much higher right now.
I think the biggest mistake was to chase down Rain and walking into storms, or flying into storms in the Vikings case. And right now, this really feels like a low-tier army with the Marines, Mortars, and Medivacs against basically everything that Protoss can make, and that's good in late-game. Colossus, Tempest, Archon, Templars behind it.
Yeah, and he finds that base down to the bottom right-hand corner as well. This was the last remaining proper mining base for Polt that is properly fueling that economy. Yes, he has his fourth base still, but that's about to run out. This push from Polt is a nice one.
Oh, wow.
Trying to shut down some of this, but the storms
not
will land.
Not here.
Oh, and he actually catches that pylon just before he's able to warp in some Zealots. And really nice snipe out there from Polt. He's keeping his hopes alive here for just a little bit, drawing an entire of Rain's army back up to the top.
And he's got it on supply, but there's still no ghost in sight here to be made. And he's going to need ghosts. He's definitely going to need ghosts to beat this army.
He absolutely has to have them, but he just isn't replenishing them. It's like every single the mining base he had down to the bottom right-hand corner never had the gas geysers added to it. He was always just dropping mules there, really focusing on his minerals. He has a little bit of gas, but really not much. He's losing a lot of his army up here.
Yeah, a single Dark Templar on the bottom right-hand side is actually trying to take out that planetary fortress that has 10 kills right now. And Rain has expanded behind this. He took a fifth base. Could be transferring some probes there momentarily. Oh, these Colossi were out of position.
Oh, big, big storms. That's the majority of Polt's army actually being killed off there. And he actually catches a medevac on the retreat out there. So again, it's 170 army supply to 105. Both players very, very even in that regard. But
yeah,
he still needs the quality. Where's the quality from Polt? Oh, it's not. It doesn't exist.
Retempest, man. They're going to be really helping in the next fight. But I think Rain, he really needs to remake some Colossus here. Why is he not remaking them? He doesn't have that much money. He's kind of broke, to be honest.
Come on, mules rolling down.
He's going to be mining from two bases, and he's warped in a lot of Templars on his new base that he just took. He's making some cannons there. It's good to have the Tempest, but usually they are just support in addition to the Colossus.
It really feels right now that Rain has this game 99% secured. He's just looking for the ability to basically make Polt GG without actually taking a direct engagement, because he's not 100% sure what he actually has to hand.
Polt is fighting like a champ, though, man.
Yeah,
he's
is.
He's retaking bases, and he's really trying to make something happen, remaking as much units as he can. Could be catching an Archon middle of the map, but the army is actually behind. Look at how many Archons Rain has.
Exactly. And he needs
18
ghosts.
Total.
Where are the ghosts? They need to
The thing is,
come out.
They're expensive, and Polt's economy and his income is not high enough for him to be able to get them out, so he prefers getting more motors, more marines, but ultimately it's going to be so hard for him to face this army of his opponents.
He's basically saying it's up to my control, it's up to my micro, it's up to my splits. I have to somehow, some way outmaneuver my opponent constantly here in the shoes of Polt. And he happens to get out of there. Those Archons taking a few pot shots for free. That's a really high intense army that Rain currently has.
Rain is so patient. Could have actually gone for it here, but I think he's going to wait to maybe be maxed out, or at least for his Templars to be there. And Polt has sneaked. This is deja vu, by the way. We've seen this before. He took a base.
Yeah.
This was a similar situation, but Mirror. He was on the other side of the map, and he flew a base somewhere, retook it, saturated it, and then had a sick comeback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did. Will he be able to do that again is the big question. He's actually going to go for the fight once again, and the Storms land against a lot of this. But the flank from the right-hand side here as Polt tries to barrage at this army. But once again, the Storms tear this entire bio force apart. It's very, very hard for him to hold on right now. Even Dark Templars are in the mix there. So if he doesn't notice, oh, he does now with that scan, he's going to take quite a bit of damage. He's got to be so careful about how he engages.
Polt is actually stutter-stepping against the Tempest and Archons and Zealots. This is crazy here. He's going to have to steam again.
Ooh.
More units coming in from here. The Tempest might die.
Yeah, those Marines are going to be able to bring him down if they actually keep on form. But the Archons will come back, and the control there for Polt was a little bit mishapped. And, well, he's trying to micro on back against this, but there's just too many Zealots.
It's just not possible to win at this point with those upgrades without Ghosts. There is so many Zealots, and I think Rain is done it here.
It's 3-3-2 upgrades on the entire Protoss army, aside from, well, the Tempest, for obvious reasons. It's just the ground, majoritively. And
the
Rain.
Tempest do have plus 2 attack. Well, the single Tempest that we see, and two more Colossi are being made in the meantime. Polt is going for that right-hand side base. I think he knows it's here.
And it's only Zealous and one Archon there. There's a High Templar, two High Templars at the back, but they don't actually have energy for the Storm. But those Archons from the left-hand side looking to sandwich this entire army, and that's going to do it. GG for game number one. Rain is able to take it after a blistering 38-minute game, and he just takes a drink and just keeps on with life.
I remember you saying twice after two of Rain's victories that he did not break a sweat in those series. Definitely broke one here, because this really looks scary at a moment here in the game. And Polt, I really like the way he played this up until the point he chased the army of his opponents. You do have to take fights sometimes in StarCraft. It's kind of part of the game, and he took a not so good one. Definitely could have had some extra barracks, man. 8 barracks when you're on, 6 bases? That's a little bit too little. And also, as much as he was on 3 Starports, by the way, one of those was missing an add-on, and one of those was on a tech lab. Yeah. So he could make only 4 Vikings at a time behind it. So you could say he was only on 8 barracks, but he had the 3 Starports, but could only make 4 units at a time instead of 6 Vikings.
Yeah, you're very right. It's certainly a very good thing to point out here. Well, we've already seen a fantastic game number one. Let's move on to game number two here in just a second. Polar Knight will be our map. And I've just got to say, Todd, this tournament has been, in terms of the level of play,
I think the best tournament I've ever cast. The every single game has really not let down.
I feel like these days, every tournament that happens, every single time the level's higher, just because StarCraft has got so competitive.
Yeah.
And this is really the case here. Every tournament that I go to, the games are always better and better every single time. All of those players, man, they are pushing the game very, very far.
They certainly are. And we got the best of the best here. And especially the round of four is looking amazing. Rain is currently sat one game up in this best of five. Polar Knight is our next map. Both of these guys could quite happily take this on to another big, big macro game. But Polar Knight is a little bit more of an aggressive map. So maybe we'll see something a bit crazier from one of them. But, I mean, their standard go-to is macro. So it's going to be interesting to see what they actually want to do here. All right, well, hopefully we'll be getting into this in just a second.
Polar Knight here. Mm-hmm. So if they go for similar things, actually, I would expect action to happen earlier, just because this is a much smaller map. Keep in mind also, this was with the positions that they were in, it was a little bit harder to attack. You know, you have to cross the entire map. And yeah, I just really like the way Paul played this up until a certain point. And he has to be... He has to feel disappointed about that first game too, because he was doing a ton of work, but then his composition and all that maybe was barely not good enough for Rain. Actually, Rain, I was surprised that he engaged at the time he did, because you're not supposed to attack into a planetary fortress and against a Terran who's already basically set up to receive you. He kind of faked or feinted weakness, you know what I mean? He attacked, he was losing a bit of units. Mm-hmm. He got EMP'd and then he's like, oh, damn it, I need to go back. And then a Polt chases him, and Rain turns around and storms everything.
All right, well, as you can probably hear, game number two is now about to begin. As we have Polt and Rain facing off against one another. Rain currently one game up. And that man is going to be spawning up to the north. Our SK Telecom T1 representative, it is Rain. And down to the south, we have our blue Terran representing CM Storm. It's Polt.
Captain now, America here.
I've got to ask Todd,
yes.
Does Polt go back to three racks play opener here in game number two?
He doesn't have to. I think he was doing well with the build that he went for. And to be honest, as good as he's done with his three racks build right now, it really feels like he can play anything he wants.
That's true.
He has to think about what could be best versus Rain. Now, he tried something in the previous game. Does he think that his style or what he used was not good enough to beat Rain? Or how to explain this? Or does he think that the execution was not good enough? And he goes for a similar style, but tries to execute it better. Sometimes it's going to be very hard to not be result orientated, which means you lose and you blame your strategy on it. While the execution was not good enough. It's very hard to realize.
Yeah,
you need to basically replay the game in your head many, many times. And now, going to this game, the choice needs to already be made too. Because if Polt is still thinking about that last game, he's not going to be as focused as he would be otherwise.
So he needs to move on. Just needs to play this as a separate
entity. He needs to have moved on.
Yes.
And he needs to have drawn conclusions already during the small break that they had between the two games. And during the end of the game where he kind of already knew he had lost.
Well,
and this is so hard to do.
I can only imagine. I've never been a pro gamer, Todd. You have been sat in the booth and in the chairs many times, so I will trust your judgment. As we have that Reaper now being sent out here for Polt to have a look around on a map like this, and there is a pylon at the very back there, and he's only left two in gas for now.
You and your pylons.
I like the pylons, man. I mean, that pylon at the back there, he could hide some tech there quite happily.
Yeah, it's not the first time Rain has placed his second pylon in such a position. We've seen him before, actually on Yeonsu, putting it in the very corner of his base.
Yeah.
Around that space where Reaper can leap in. And third pylon's going to go down, I guess, since he's on two gases. That makes sense. Whereas Polt is again going for a Reaper, command center, and reactor. Oh, that SCV in the bottom right-hand side of his base, man. I thought he was maybe going to throw down something crazy.
Oh.
Like a very quick eBay.
And then it was a supply depot. You were sorely disappointed, Todd. Anyway, we have the bunker being added on at the front here, so Polt can just play out this two-base style to the best of his ability. And the SCV is going to check around up to the top left-hand corner, just in case there's anything crazy going on. But from Rain, it's usually not the case, as Pulse just making sure he's secure.
Yeah, he's going all the way around the map. This is such a smart way to play, too, to make sure there's no kind of proxy. Again, Rain, not really the player to do that all that often, but the one time he catches you off guard, you're going to pay for it.
Twilight Council time.
And I really like that Pult is doing all this work. Sadly for him, he's not going to be able to find anything, and you are right.
It's the tech pylon. Well, it's going to be hard to get in there and really see what it is with a Reaper, and that's one of the great positions that is there for this map on Polar Knight. But chances are this Reaper's going to get straight on in there and see it instantly.
Yeah.
Well, let's see.
You think this is Darkshrine or Blink? I think Blink. Oh, yeah, he's getting two additional gateways.
Yeah.
I think definitely going to be Blink.
Is he going to suicide? No, he's not.
Very low chance that will be a Darkshrine here. And this is funny because Pult, he's gone for his, I guess you could call it anti-Blink build here, or at least good build versus Blink.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't win out every single time, but we've seen it win for Pult more so than not, as he is gearing up for that. And it has all been spotted by the Mothership Core.
That Tech Lab. You see where that Tech Lab is?
It's quite vulnerable.
At the closest barracks from the big ramp. So Pult, if he does not know this is coming, if he gets surprised, this could go very, very bad for him. Then again, this is not the four gateways. This is just three gateways so far in total out of Rain. Could be going for Robo or something like that behind this. But he did see that there was only three barracks and no factory, so I don't really expect him to go for a very, very quick Robo. He's going to look to basically warp in Stalkers 3x3 and at some point try... Ooh, he survives if he gets into the main.
Yeah, all the Stalkers
and
are out of place.
This is going to help. And Paul's moving to the middle of the map. And this is not necessarily a bad thing. We've seen him before with those very nice counterattacks. We might have... Oh, Rain is going for the back door.
Whoa. Wait a minute.
He wants to take out those rocks and get into the base where there is no bunker.
Isn't this the command center here for Pult also a little bit quicker than normal?
Yeah, it is.
Because he could be getting abused here. There is the bunker going down to the back though, so Pult now knows that there is going to be some pressure coming on.
Does Pult notice that this is happening? I'm watching with his view right now. He's going to get into the natural of his opponent. He should be able to realize what this is. There is no photon recharge ready. He looks at the rocks. He sees that this is coming. He starts bunkers.
But he doesn't have any defense back at home, does Rain? So these few units at the front are doing a good job of shutting down the mining at this natural.
Both players going to have to salvage the situation as well as possible. Rain has a choice to make. Does he warp in Stalkers back at home? And that's what he does. He gets four Stalkers back at home.
For the defense, he really wants to save that natural. SCVs. Very important. But meanwhile, at the back here, he actually gets the bunker. Time Warp helping out, but the Mothership Core will end up falling. So no ability to have that high ground vision as much as he would like to. This could actually be shut down as Pult is actually not only holding on at the front, but he's holding on at the back
as
well.
He's going to get the Nexus.
He's going to, this is completely, I don't know how Wenzel will do this.
He has not defended back at home yet. He needs more SCVs to help against this. Blink's being used.
Yeah, very good control here. There's a couple of Zealots at the front tanking up a little bit of damage. He's now starting to focus down some of those Marauders. He brings the one down. There's two remaining. That is not really enough Stalkers, but they killed the expansion. They killed it off. Even more probes have to come off the line. This Mothership Core is out and about once again because it has to be replenished, but it doesn't have energy to throw in a Photon Overcharge. Paul is controlling this fantastically.
20 probes are left for Rain. He's all in. He's all in at this point. He's up against three command center, three orbitals already.
Blinks.
And I think Pult needs to pull back with this army.
Look at the retention of these
or
units, but they don't have Blink anymore. He's able to break through it. Pult, GG. Game number two goes to the Terran. He ties up the series 1-1. And wow, what a start to this best of five.
Yeah, what a game here we just saw. I actually thought that there was going to be maybe too many Stalkers for Pult to be able to win the fight at the ramp over here, at the ramp down his initial ramp from his main, but no, those Stalkers, they were red, Steam Pack was used, and Pult, he handled that as good as you ever could, I think.
Yes,
I think so. He targeted everything right, he targeted the probes, the Nexus, then the Stalkers when he had to. He defended at home very, very well. I do think he could have maybe had the SCVs in position on that first bunker to maybe try and repair it with like more SCVs, but overall, what a sick hold we just saw.
He still went for
the third orbital command. He went for the... I'm a little bit surprised he didn't start some Widow Mines, but he was really focusing on getting more Bioforces to help and defend against this. And that was insane.
Very, very nicely done. And the thing is, again, it comes back to what we said at the beginning. If anybody can beat Mr. Rain, it's Pult. And we actually are not just giving you cast a dribble there when we say that. That is down and absolutely true. Pult here... is now 1-1 against Rain. Of course, he did drop a map in the previous series as well. But Paul looks good there. Paul looked good. Now he's going to probably have to contest against some kind of macro focus from Rain once again, because it's Habitation Station where we saw him going up to those 7 Colossi last time. That was a scary play.
And also Rain here, he tried to play a little bit differently. He tried to play with some blink play. Paul's, luckily for him, I think if he had gone for his factory build that he did in the previous game, it would have been much harder to deal with this, because Rain probably would have gone into defensive mode at least early on to make sure he can defend against the Widow Mines, the Marines, and then he would have attacked. In this case, this was what I guess you could call, again, the anti-Blink Stalker play or build from Paul's, and he does so well with this. You know, I have to wonder, if you suspect, basically if you see that you're up against 3 barracks and you think this is going to be this build, as a Protoss, you definitely need to leave some units at one of the watchtowers to see if your opponent's headed for you. And if Rain had done that, he might have been able to get enough units back at home to defend against that first wave of Paltz. And then he could have brought those Stalkers to help on with the aggression. And Paltz, having gone for a third command center, that would have been very hard for him to hold. So the lack of scouting here by Rain definitely cost him the game too. He did not see this army coming. If Marines and Marauders reach your middle line, your army is out of position, you already don't deserve to win.
Yeah, that was a tough one there for Rain, as he committed to something, and unfortunately it didn't work out. Now let's get on to game number 3. We already saw Rain play an amazing game here in his previous series. Will he be able to do it again, as we have spawning up to that top left-hand corner our Red Protoss representing SK Telecom T1, it's Rain. And up to the top right, tying up the series in this round of 4 match, representing CM Storm, it's Paul.
Paul played so good that last game, man. And Rain being 23-2 in maps, now he's 1-1 against Paltz. Mm-hmm. He has to think, this guy, he does not respect me. He does not respect my stats. He's he's really bringing it to me. So on this map, we've seen Rain before use his standard build with some nice robo placement. I expect the exact same thing in this game here out of him.
But again, if you come back to that game number 2, imagine Paltz having to try and deal with that blink attack with going for barracks, factory, starport. So, you know, that 3 barracks play that we're seeing from Paltz really holds him on so strongly.
And I wonder if I think he was expecting standard play too. This is because he hadn't scouted much. He didn't see the Twilight. He didn't see the 2 additional gateways. He was going to move forward with his units regardless of what he was up against. And that's interesting, the way those 2 players go on about trying to beat each other. And actually, Rain opens with a single gas on this map. So maybe a 1 gas expand. Look where he's rallied his Nexus. The corner of his base to get a cheeky pylon.
Uh-oh.
What does that tell you? Actually, I think he does that very often.
He does.
Just for scouting just for good positioning to later.
But it could be for a starport. It could be. It could be for a Stargate. Let's hope. Rain would be changing things up if he did that, to be honest. But in this best of 5, where his opponent just shut down his blink play, it would be nice to see him maybe go for a little change. But still, the game he played out in the previous series on this map with the Roba behind the mineral line at the natural was such a strong game. Very, very difficult for his previous Terran opponent to really do anything about. So we could see that bust out again.
A Zealot started. I have to wonder, is this a 1-gate Nexus with a Zealot cancel? Or is he going to go for Zealot, Stalker, and Mothership Core Pressure? Actually, yeah, I think he wants to throw down the Nexus here. And he might... I guess he's going to cancel. I'm surprised Paul doesn't try to block a little bit more, but since this is his first scout here, it's more important to see the main than to be on the expansion. And then sometimes you're going to get tricked. You know, you're going to stay on the expansion. There's going to be a Stargate going up in the corner of the base, as you had kind of wished it would have been. And you're going to get tricked. Well, need to be careful.
Yeah, he adds on the second gas here as well, just to transition on to that more tech-based route. And the Reaper!
Is the Robo Pylon going up here?
It is the Robo Pylon, man.
If Paltz has seen
these pylons,
Rain's previous games on this map, which I'm sure he has, he should be able to realize that just with that pylon placement, that it's more likely that Rain will go for the same robo like before and same build.
Yeah. And actually, that would be the sickest mind game if he like sees that pylon, knows that Paul actually saw his previous games, and he like goes over to the right-hand side now
and he makes
and
double
puts the Stargate down. I'm like, whoa! That would be super, super sick. All based off pylon positioning, which would be crazy. But for now, we have the triple barracks play once again here from Pult. So it's his go-to standard once again.
Yeah, this is what really has brought him a lot of success so far in this tournament.
It's in the wrong place.
Imagine the natural gets scanned and then he misses the robo.
Yeah.
That would be sick.
That really would be. Well, we'll find out in just a little bit. Well, Pult's going to try and poke on up, and he can't really on Habitation Station. Yeah. It's much harder for that Reaper to get in. We've alluded to it many times before. We've actually cast a lot of PVT today, haven't we?
Yeah. I feel like Pult, when he doesn't know what he's up against, going for this build seems like a very viable option for him, just because he knows how to handle every situation. He has enough Marines for an Oracle. Against Blink, we've seen him do very, very well. Against Dark Templars, he could be in trouble, actually. This could be the weakness of this one build here, if he's not careful. But luckily for him, Rain does not seem to want to go for any kind of Dark Templar build right now. We'll see if he scans. If he tries to get more information. Usually, Pult's information, he gets through aggression. Mm. With that first wave, it's always the same one. It's always 9 Marines and 1 Marauder, actually. Never changed.
Yeah, and it's actually, we'll do all right here, at least a little bit, at least Photon Overcharge, because he doesn't really have too much opportunity to warp in some sentries here to block off that ramp, so he could actually poke up there if he's quick about it, and at least get that one Photon Overcharge.
You know, this is a bit of a gamble, the way Pulse played this. If there was an Oracle flank to his mineral line or Dark Templar play, he would have been in lots of trouble here, but he did see there was only a single gas opener before the Nexus, and then later on the second gas added, but It would be hitting around now. He doesn't have an eBay. So really here, he's playing to his opponent's image, I feel.
And look at that. Pult sends a Marine straight up to that goal base to keep an eye out there as well.
Wait a second. We have a Twilight Council and a Forge, by the way. Mm-hmm. So this is not going to be the classic Robo Bay into Twilight Council with Colossus and Blink. Does he go for a charge? Since he's getting attacked, this... Oh, Dark Shrine!
Whoa!
DT drop! He's going to go DT drop. He already has the robo. He makes the Dark Shrine in his natural.
Oh, my.
It's going to be so hard for Pult to spot this. He either scan or I don't think he sees it on time because...
This just wasn't a change that we were expecting, though. This is really not it. This is going to be hitting him hard if he's not careful. Because did he ever see the robo? He didn't see it, did he? And he's also spreading himself out across three locations here. So he's going to... If this hits at just the right time...
Yeah. He already has the eBay, but without knowing about the Dark Templars, it's going to be so hard to know about them. Then again, the Dark Shrine is 50 seconds away from finishing. We're going to have some medivacs starting soon, but I don't think they're going to be there on time to be able to spot anything. Information through aggression is good, but in this case, it might not come on time.
It certainly might not do. He starts Immortal production with this as well.
Oh, Paul's getting a turret, that is natural.
Oh,
this
nice.
Guy is so smart. He knows that, you know, this is a minimal investment.
But that's why the Warp Prism's there, Todd. That's why the Warp Prism's there, to counteract that and just go elsewhere.
All right, if you don't have a scan for your natural, you're at least going to have one for your main. And not needing one for the natural, this is definitely going to help in this situation. You're observing the game, by the way, now.
No, I'm not. Sick recovery by Funker. he made it work.
Yeah, you are. It's not moving right now.
No.
Okay, okay. Let's get for a sec.
So anyway, two Dark Templars do warp in with that warp prism, and he's going to look to move straight on in here with that. Although, where is he going with this? He just got spotted. That was a weird direction he chose.
This was seen, and now Pult is going to know. He has one scan ready. He has two scans ready. And he has a turret in his natural.
This could be cleaned up. This could be cleaned up really nicely.
It's going to get cleaned up. And Rain has no idea about the third base. The guy who plays with so much information, who has three observers in the middle of the map right now, he has no idea that there is that third base up.
Did he have the offensive observer? There's not one there to be able to spot anything. This
and
is
no,
uncharacteristic.
This has done no damage. Pult is on 5 barracks. He's adding on add-ons. He's just in a great position. Then again, we've seen Rain recover from worse.
Yes, we have.
He's getting the Templar Archives now, probably the best transition you can do out of this.
Yeah, I'm liking that. Especially since he's got charge well and truly underway from the position he was in with this attempt at harassment at least. But it hasn't really done a whole lot. The Dark Templars haven't paid for themselves. All it's done is keep Pult away from his side of the map for a while. So for now, Rain's still putting on some harassment. This is a buy-time tactic.
I didn't take Rain for the Sturborn type, and neither did Pult, apparently, because this kind of surprised him. Didn't do all that much damage in the end, but decent. considering to what he could have done if Polt had been ready.
Three Immortals in this mix packs a lot of punch, though.
I think he's on 8 gateways. And then Rain has actually cut probe production for quite some time here. Does he go for a 2-base timing? What is this we're seeing? This is not the Rain we are used of seeing. 18 probes per minute line.
Ah, that one Viking. Ah, he's only just going to warp in units and then try and go in anyway. So
he's
going
to use the warp prism to reinforce? He's going all in?
I think he's just dropping.
No. He should... okay, he's dropping, but... I really think he wants to be super aggressive right now. He's cut probe production. This is not supposed to happen. He wants to reinforce with units 8x8 because he has charge.
Ah, but this is a great position that Paul has defensively in the middle of this map. He's greeting this army with major gusto. All he has to do is deal with this drop reinforcements, and then his army in the middle of the map is very, very powerful. Chasing these Immortals down, killing that Zoth. That's a lot of firepower that Rain actually loses. He recalls straight on out there, though. A good pickup from Rain, but he's losing a lot.
And he's getting Archons now. Storm was never researched. Paul with so much more supply than his opponent. 60 army supply to 34. Rain. How is Rain going to hold? I know he's good at holding, but there are limits here.
Yeah, this is desperation mode for Rain here, especially since the timer is against him with that third base for Polt down to the bottom right, mining away steadily and happily. There's not really a whole big opportunity here for Rain to do a whole lot. He's having to sit back and get Storm and try and get a third base, but that could be punished.
Rain's probably in a desperation mood right now. As he starts Storm, he starts another War Prism. We have a Viking in position ready to handle this, and Polt, he must know he's in a great position right now. He's on 3 bases, he's well saturated. No third base in sight for Rain. He's actually thinking about starting it here for a second, but he's not even well saturated on the bases that he has because he's cut pro production. Yeah. He invested so much into this attack, but there was already too much for Polt. He did not realize it on time because he had observers in defensive posture, and Rain is in so much trouble here. This could be the 2-1 lead that Polt needs.
And now, well, this is going to be difficult for him. Psionic Storm's just about to finish. He picks up a lot, though, up to the top left-hand corner.
Medivac drop was missed.
There's not that many units for him to be able to deal with that either. The entire tier of his army is at the front here trying to deal with this push. He drops the Storm, yes, but this is all a ruse. Polt goes straight into the main. He tries to warp in some units, but they could die off very, very quickly here. It's only Zealots. He needs a High Templar here. Foreign Overcharge has been activated. He's trying to bring down some of those Medivacs during all
the
this
Nexus
as well.
Is going to go down, I think.
Falling very rapidly, and it might end up falling. Those High Templars trying to get in position, but it doesn't really matter. Even if he does get them in position, the Storms will deny that from happening, but he's still hitting the natural. If he can bring this Nexus down, another great defensive Storm will try and push this away. I can't believe it. How does Rain actually hold on to both Nexi despite that great multi-pronged attack?
Yeah, actually, Polt thought he could get that Nexus in the main, and he misread this. So did I. I really thought this was a good choice, but now he's been held, and Rain, again, he's moving out. This definitely has to be an all-in. He cannot. It's so hard to expand behind this. Yes, he knows that right now, he should be able to know. He knows that there is a third base well saturated from his opponent, and Paul's gonna have so much units.
The thing is,
we have two ghosts on the way, but they are the two first ones being made.
Rain has one Storm in him. He's got just about to add on a few more though. Like two or three of these High Templars are about to have another Storm, so he'll have three or ish available. And he sees it.
He needs to pull SCVs. He pulls them in advance.
He knows that he's in a great position. If he can just hold on, he should be able to win this. He pulls the SCVs from the third base as well. He's going to come in from the left-hand side, try and deal with this. Storm to the back. Will he be able to hold on? Will Rain? I don't think so. This army might end up falling pretty rapidly. No more Storms available to him as the High Templars fall. The Zealots trying to crush through a lot of them. There's actually Dark Templars in that mix as well. Yeah, they're providing a lot of damage.
They did so much, and now those Immortals, they really help too, but they are going to fall.
Paul just has a double, almost double the army supply now. Yes, his third base is under assault, and technically, worker-wise, it's 44 to 21. So once again, these two go down to the wire. So, so close.
Paul getting the ghost just a little bit too late here against what he was up against. And really, those big drops being held as they were. Paul's only taking down the shield on those Nexi.
He sees how little energy those High Templars have.
How does he escape with them?
Exactly.
They're so slow.
They can't get away. He has to turn around with the Zealots. He has to buy time for them to somehow make it across
energy.
The map.
70 energy on all of them. 71.
Wait, recall? Recall to the F-Mass recall?
He doesn't have two. 73.
Oh,
he almost has Storm.
Okay, so he could turn around and fight now that he has a little bit of Storm.
And Paul seems to know. He turns around himself. Paul's actually forgetting about a lot of his units here. He's going to pick up those... Oh no, he's going to go for a drop. He's going to go for a counterattack. He's going to keep barely enough back at home to hold in case... he changes his mind.
Oh my god.
These guys, they're going to give me a heart attack. 4 Storms are ready here for Rain. And how does Paul fight? He has more armies to play, but he doesn't have ghosts still.
That Dark Templar heading down to that third base could shut down the mining there quite quickly. Because right now, I mean, Rain's income is actually quite good. He's positioned his units to go for a big flank by the looks of things.
Yeah, could have gone for a counterattack too, but I think he wants to be able to hold his army once and for all.
Get out of there. Well, 105 supply to 97 right now. This army is actually just going to go to the counter, the stray counter, whilst he tries to hold on at his ramp. But that's a lot of zealots. We'll go back for a second.
You know what Paul should do? Should go up his ramp, make a wall there, and counterattack with this. And just make sure he spreads units out enough not to get stormed. But it looks like, actually the Templars are going head in first. Time Warp's being used.
This is the time he has to go. The Time Warp as well as Storm, a great combination, but that Mothership Core does get brought out from the skies very quickly. More Storms will land on a lot of this bio, but realistically, it does split up there. Yeah. They did hit accurately, but in the end now, over the other side of the map, the bio force has killed off the Nexus. They're killing off every single probe. And, it's full base train mode.
Port is going to get a draw at least, because no probe is outside the main base, so I'm sorry for breaking the hype here, but...
You're entirely right. It's at least a draw in favor of Paul if he decides to just fly into the corner of a map or something like that, because he brings down that last Nexus. Where are the 13 probes, actually? Are they 10 probes? Oh, okay.
They're in the main. Some of them might escape. A Dark Templar is doing quite some damage. He's going to scan.
There's
still some SCVs in the natural of Paul, but can he get any more units out? The army supply right now, 36 for Paul, 34 for Rain, who has Storm versus no Ghost.
Yeah, these probes are just not going to escape. He knew the severity of the situation and will chase those down. Army supplies right now, 29 to 34. Unit counts, 9 SCVs against 0.
There is some things that Paul can do that will really, really be really, really, really good. He could take, for example, the Galt, wall it off with his barracks, and drop his units behind those barracks so that the Zealots cannot attack.
Yeah, it's only Zealots, 2 Archons, and a Stalker.
But does he think about it? It's so hard to think about it in the situation. It's easy for us because we see everything.
Yeah. He only has he has no SCVs. No SCVs, but he does still have that orbital command, doesn't he? He has 3. So he should be okay in this regard. Technically, Polk can do some replenishing, but he has to pick up and get out of there.
Yeah,
he's getting
sandwiched. What is he doing?
Whew. You need to save every unit here, Paul. That's important.
And Rain has no anti-medivacs here except for that one Stalker that does not have Blink and 2 Archons. Does he think, he's landing his barracks. He has a little bit of money. He's landing them at the gold.
Is he going to make units?
That's one Archon. He's going to get killed.
This one Archon gets sacrificed. Refuses to chase it. But you're right. He actually needs to spend this money on SCVs. He's going to try and at least one SCV will come out. Where is it?
He has orbitals, so he has mules.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
But he needs a good mining base, not that bottom right-hand side one that's almost burning here, and which might be found in a second, but that one hero zealot.
Yeah, good job by Rain to scout these eventualities out. But again, his army is kind of waning. Any zealot that dies, any Archon, any single unit that dies is bad.
He took the gold. This could be seen if a unit, if he starts mining from it and a unit is at the watchtower and Paul's buying himself some time. Really, if he landed his barracks at the ramp and put his units behind, there is nothing that can kill him.
That's true, but also...
We have no storms left.
Yeah, as long as Polk keeps controlling properly and keeping an eye on his army, there's nothing that can actually beat him here because he has the mobility factor of those medivacs. And even more Marines pop out.
He has to be very careful, though, because those units, they die very, very quickly. One mistake here, he loses too many units, and this is going to be a draw. He's still in the lead, in my opinion. And this gold is actually going to be attacked here. He's going to have to evacuate, and those Marines...
Oh, he's doing it.
The medivac. He had planned for it.
Yeah,
he's... Evacuation.
He's eventually trying to wall off as well here with all of these barracks, but right now, actually, he could seal those in and then make mules on the other side and then just trap them in.
Two zealots in the main of Bolts, which I'm not even sure we can call it his main anymore. It's just like a burning place with some add-ons being left there. He's actually taking quite some damage. He needs to save this.
He does. He's just trying to kill off all the buildings he can.
Yeah.
The thing is that, again, guys, we are the eyes in the skies. We can see everything going on the map, whereas both of these players have limited vision, have limited ability to fully gauge the other person's position.
Yes.
Other than the fact that Polt knows how many buildings his opponent has left and there's no extra Nexus been started so far.
Oh, this bottom right-hand side base is going to be found again. And the command center in the main, he died.
That could have been avoided.
Is Rain really going to draw this? I really think that Paul should still be able to win. Oh, he has to be careful. His units are being caught.
Have to pick up and get out of there.
Medivac getting really on hit points.
Yeah,
look at the minerals and gas for Paul here, who actually, he has a single SCV on the map. It's all the way down there. It's made a depot and Does start something like a starport to try to get a cloak banshee.
He should
something.
Make more depots so that he can actually make some units if he finds a place to land, I guess. Because right now he's at 28 to 30 supply.
Oh, he has a starport alive. He's going to try to land it at the other goals.
Oh, God. If he got eight.
But there's
banshee.
A Zealot there.
Yeah.
This is Battleship all over again.
It's hide and seek, man.
Wrong game.
He's just going to continue killing off buildings. And eventually, slowly, Polt does win this scenario. But... it's,
oh, actually,
What? Pick up, run away. He gets a marauder for his troubles. How many buildings do we have left for Rain? We have all of this on the left-hand side and then Pylon in the middle, and that's it. This one Archon's getting himself a barracks kill in the middle. Good for him.
I think this is tough. Paul needs to do more work with mining on his bases on the left-hand, on the right-hand side. He's only using
tech
one
lab.
Medivac at a time on the left-hand side.
Yes, tech yes. lab, banshees and cloak.
This should never get found. But then again, Rain has found everything so far.
Yeah.
Does he go there? Is he seriously going there?
He's being so proactive about this.
Oh, he's barely out of vision.
Oh, Rain!
Oh, he sees it. And you know what? This starport is very low on hit points.
Yeah.
He needs to
it's
lift up
burning.
And leave. Stop. He's,
even
he's
if he started
attention.
Lifting and running away, now it still starts burning, I think. It's going to be close. Oh, he's actually focusing on the tech lab, so it might not do.
You see, there is a single Zealot on the right-hand side gold. Paul should land his units there, kill this, retake the gold. This is what he's going to do. And every time he does all of the things a little bit too late, the depot was found.
The base down to the bottom right is still mining, though, Todd.
There is two SCVs out on the map. And he's getting depots on the right-hand side. Those should not be found.
Just
but
made
then
them
again,
everywhere.
Rain has found everything so far. He keeps on scouting the entire map with all the Zealots he has.
Can't believe this game's
oh, the one
is
the main is going to be picked off on the right top right-hand side. Those units kill the one Zealot.
Slowly, he's broken it down from 15 Zealots to 10. So
yeah.
It is slowly making progress. But
still 30 army supply to 26, though.
Yeah, it's those two Archons really making up the bulk of it. And they are still formidable. You've got the Archons are one of the best
depots units. Were found on the right-hand side. Are you kidding me?
It's really weird this, because Archons are one of the best units to have in this situation, because they have so many shields and then they recharge them all very quickly.
Ooh, that orbital command on the bottom right hand side is very low on hit points, by the way.
He got the medevac as well as the units up to the top left. I can't believe this. Unit counts. What do we have? We have 5 marauders.
You know, Port
five
can
marines.
Still do what I talked about earlier. He can steal wall of the golds and land his command center behind it and start mining from it, but the bottom right-hand side command center is where he's investing his time now to really try and mine most minerals that he's mining. The thing is, he has, how many? 3 SCVs. 2 of those are at that base. If they are found, and actually the other one was found, where it was making a depot all the way down the map, he has no more SCVs, and his supply blocked. Bolt!
Uh-oh.
What have you done? He's going to do the thing what I said.
Yeah, he can repair this with mules. You said this about 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, but then
ago,
he cannot build SCVs.
He can repair with mules, right? And then eventually he can...
Yeah, but he cannot build any more army. How does he get more army if he cannot build SCVs and make depot?
How is he on supply blocked? What happened? Did he drop
supply?
Actually,
he lost some of his army.
Yeah, I guess so. Repair! Repair with mules!
He lost the packing.
Repair with mules! Todd, you've solved the puzzle about 15 minutes ago. Congratulations. Oh no, don't burn the barracks down! Ah! Okay, he got the barracks.
He's gonna move the other one. Oh, and Rain, he's gonna go for it.
To
he knows
mules.
That he has no time here.
Oh, dear me.
He cannot wait. He cannot wait. He knows that he's going to lose for sure if he does not go. So he's going to go.
Repair.
Pull back the Zealots.
Shoot.
He needs to kill that barracks and get in there.
He can't break through. Those Archons can't even reach those units at the bio.
This has to be a tier 4 Polt.
Oh, my.
You know, I really thought this was the best way, and apparently Polt agrees with me here.
Yeah. This is bizarre. He's making Marines. He's going for it. GG! GG! Polt 2-1! Polt 2-1! if anybody can do it, it's Polt, and apparently even in that game, even in that bizarre, crazy game, Polt is able to eke it out. Wow.
He definitely broke a sweat, as you would say.
Dude, I broke a sweat. I mean, I think everyone, look, that is the most concern we have seen Rain all tournament long. He is in a bad position. It's match point for him. He was one of the favorites coming into this tournament, but now he is worried 100%. This is what a series.
I don't know if there was anybody that was not on Team Polt yet, but now they definitely should be after this game, because this was pretty insane. Very good crisis management. Even he didn't have the ghost That made it very, very tricky for him to fight against 4 Templars, 5 Templars, a lot of his army. I like the SCV pool. So many of his reactions were very, very good here. Mm. Going for the full surrounds. But man, those Zealots plus Templars and Immortals, they are quite scary. And they almost won the game to a Rain who was oh so far behind. And as much as I really liked his choice to go for the attack here, Polt handled that good enough in the end, barely good enough to win the game.
All right, well, game number 4 will be on the way soon. Yeonsu is our map between Polt and Rain. Okay, so this is just my personal opinion of this, purely. But if Polt is able to win this series, then considering how we've seen Rain play PvT the past couple of months, I am absolutely blown away if Polt can make it to the final. And right now, he's sitting on one last game to make it there. Not only to the grand final, but the Intel Extreme Master Katowice as well. It's crazy.
Yeah, which I'm sure he will be delighted to know he takes part in. Because if you beat Rain here, if you beat all the guys that this guy's beaten, he could very well win $100,000 in Poland. And I'm sure that's what Rain wants too. I'm a little bit surprised, I have to say, with the way Rain's played this, as we do see the final moment in this game here.
Rain GG's out, Polt very relieved, and Rain with a little bit of worry on his face there. This is a close one. And Rain knows how close that last game was. Absolutely knew every single step of how close that last game was. Was willing to battle out until the very last second, even though Rain probably knew that his opponent was able to fly buildings everywhere and keep that going.
But you always hope for a big mistake, you know?
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure when I played Happy at Home Story Cup, he knew that... some things could happen too, and sometimes you try to provoke a mistake on your opponent and he goes full Todd and then you lose.
Full Todd.
In this case, Polt went full Polt because he played good enough and he won the game, made sure he didn't throw it away, which in this case would have meant a draw. So as much as it's not that bad, it's actually that bad because it's such an important game.
I have to commend you on the winning move though there at the gold, because you did say that that was the way to deal with it. Like 10 minutes before that ended.
I had foreseen.
You had foreseen. You're doing well. You are clairvoyant today, man. All right. Well, now we're just going to get into game number 4 in just a second here. Just a slight delay on this, but what a series so far. What a series. Every single game today has been absolutely phenomenal. And Polt now is one game away from the grand final.
Yeah. You know, this is weird. The one game that Rain played his true style, he won.
Yes.
So what does he go back to now on Yeonsu? Does he try for some blink play again, which is also risky and that Polt has shown such strength, such good performance against, or does he go back to his regular style? I would say definitely he has to go back to his go-to build, what he's best at, and try to pull it off this way.
Polt breathing a sigh of relief and punching his leg. There has to be a lot of nerves going into this final. Because, again, this last two maps determines so much more than a grand final spot. But now we're going to get into this. Was that MC? Oh, God. All right, guys. The countdown has begun for game number 4. CM Storm Polt is one map away from the grand final against SK Telecom Rain, who has just looked phenomenal throughout the entire tournament, but now he's on the ropes. Game number 4. Are you ready? I know me and Todd are, as this is it. As we have, spawning down to the bottom left-hand corner, our red Protoss representing SK Telecom T1. It is Rain. And up to the top right, one map away from the grand final, representing CM Storm, it's Polt.
All right, I got a good and a bad news. Which one do you want first?
The good news, because I like ending with the bad news.
It depends who you're cheering for.
Okay.
Who are you cheering for?
I don't know. Polt. We'll go with Polt because he's looking great.
Then I only have a good news for you.
Oh, okay then.
He only won on Yeonsu so far. He beat Stardust, Mana, and Classic. He's unbeaten in this tournament and he played 3 great Protosses on it. And now he's up against Rain.
Is that because people keep getting aggressive on this map against him and he keeps just defending it?
Quite possibly. Which, again, really goes to show how important he's going to be for Rain to... play his usual style. If he plays Blink, if he plays aggressive, Polt's going to be ready. And Polt, having used his three barracks build and been so successful with it, whereas before when he went for the factory, he lost the game. I'm pretty sure we're going to be seeing him go for that build again. Rain opens with the double gas. Where does the second pylon go? Where do you think?
Up the north, a little bit of his base, over here.
You're such a quick learner, James. This is very impressive.
You're so kind. Thank you, man. I really appreciate that. There's your second pylon, Todd. Have at it. All right, anyway. But no, I would love to see Rain try and go more for the macro focus. I really would, because I would love to see a game number five, and I feel that Rain has the best chance in a big macro game.
Yeah.
So
very nice building placement here. Definitely going to be helping against possibly a Reaper getting in there and getting a scout, which Polt has opened with every single time. And Polt's going for the quick scout, whereas Rain is not scouting in this game. Already interesting that he does not go for a scout early on. And third pylon is going to go down in his main. In another corner, he's got everything covered.
He certainly does. As Mr. Polt is going to go over that barracks very quickly after that Reaper does come out. Once again here, while Sessi pokes on in, has a little bit of a look around itself. So, he's going to see. All he sees really is the three and the one. Actually, there's two in there now.
This is the Mothership Core starting here. And he knows exactly that there's basically going to be a late Nexus, if there is a Nexus, which if I was him, I would expect, and I'm still expecting, even though with that one Zealot. This is a build that we've seen CJ Hero open with a lot, getting the Zealot, Stalker, and Mothership Core, but usually really trying to pressure with it. Getting the third pylon, getting a later second Nexus, as opposed to usually, but Rain's playing it. So he's playing this in his own way. He's keeping units back at home and only scouting with the Mothership Core.
Zealot some patrol on this high ground, but the Reaper's going to jump in a location that it wasn't really anticipating. But the Stalker will push it away as well. So the Nexus gets up and running nice and quickly. No block here from Polt, not properly at least. And then he has spot the Mothership Core heading over there as well. So he should be able to push it away at least a little bit with these Marines, maybe.
Those two passing ships in the night. Again, they're back. Even though one of them is actually a battleship, again, returning with the battleships, as it can shoot down.
Yeah, man.
Two additional barracks again for Polt, and nice placement. A little bit behind. That one reactor, a little bit vulnerable to blink attacks. But then again, since everything else is so good from Polt in this situation, should be okay. He spotted the reactor.
Yeah, it's all about that tech lab on the one in the back. And it's so far away. Very, very defended. Nicely
Robo
done.
Goes down.
Oh, yeah. It's Robo time from Rain. Liking it. And then when will our Forge come down so we can have that fully fledged macro focus?
You know, this is really weird how he played in the last game. He went for the Robo, but then made a Twilight Council instead of Robo Band, which just went for the Dark Templar drop, didn't really do much, and then he's like, I'm going to go for Storm. He realized he was quite far behind on economy. I haven't done any damage onto the SCVs and mineral lines of his opponent, so he's like, you know what, I'm just going to go for an Immortal Timing. Didn't work, went to Storm, didn't work, almost worked, and then they went into that crazy base trade. So here, I really expect Rain to again go for the Robo Bay. But this has been spotted. And again, in the previous game, Todd, Polt, he had seen the Robo Bay of his opponent. He probably expected standard play. In the end, it was not. But he did really well against it.
And that Reaper does see everything, which is very, very nice for him.
Yes, so. But as I just mentioned, there could still be a different build here.
Yeah, the change-up.
Just like he did previously. But I don't think so. He's getting cannon in his middle line of his main. Boss gases and the expansion.
I mean, this is where Rain says, I am one game away from defeat. I bring out the best game I possibly can here to keep myself in this. It's an important one. It certainly is.
This is actually, sorry to interrupt, but this is an improved version of the push that we've seen Polt do usually. There is more Marines. Usually it was 9 Marines, 1 more ordered. Now there is quite a few more, but they're a little bit behind. Photon overcharge is available.
Yep, we'll activate that and push this away. A little bit, but not too much with that. And the thing is that also, you know, he starts the third base behind this.
Yeah,
so,
and this is really good. Before the 8th minute.
Yeah, it's that pressure that really keeps your opponent back that you then just say, well, I'm going to take an expansion. I know you can't pressure that. And look at this. We have the Robo Bay as well as the Twilight Council here, Todd.
And two additional gateways that you need at this time. Rain is in his comfort zone right now. He's playing his go-to build. He's getting additional probes very continuously, never getting supply blocks. Actually, he's very close to getting supply blocks. And he starts two pylons.
Don't jinx him. Don't jinx him, all right?
He's on 68 out of 68. Now he's going to actually be supply blocked for a very short time.
Yeah, at like 10 seconds or so here as he gets out of that. And then we'll continue on the production from here on out. It delayed the first Colossus by a fraction here. But Pulse, very, very unlikely to get too aggressive against this position now as he has that third command center up and running. And he's keeping an eye on his opponent's third base locations, which is very good here by Pulse early on.
Yeah, plus one's on the way, and we've seen Paul play like this before and be very successful with it. The thing is, in the first game that they played, it was just a little bit weird the way things were going and how Paul played so passive. So if he finds himself in the same situation as before now, and he has a good army composition, but he knows he's up against a lot of Colossi, Storm and all that, what does Paul go for? And we have a lot of additional gateways being thrown down here by Rain.
Is he going to go with this? They have like plus two Colossi and then the Blink?
You know, he made one more gateway than he needs at this point, actually. Usually he goes up to six and then he takes the third base.
I mean,
might still be a third base, but...
But normally he'd be going on to plus two armor instead of that plus one weapons.
No, not necessarily.
No?
The thing is, I've seen him do that before. Versus Innovation, at the time Innovation was basically unbeatable. It was on Aquilon Waste. And Rain probably thought that he was going to punish the greed of his opponent. So now, has he realized that Pulse seems to go... Yeah, he saw the third command center.
Uh-oh.
This could be a 1-1 plus blink timing with three Colossus.
There's the pylon on the left-hand side here. This is a perfect opportunity for Rain to now push on forwards. But Pulse has to identify this. He has to know what's going on. That factory was spotting, but the Stalkers alone push it away.
One way to identify this, obviously, not spotting any third base from his opponent. But
he's still
doing. We've seen Rain throw down that third base at 12, at 13 minutes. So he cannot be sure yet. The thing is, Pulse is already on two starports.
Yeah.
He's pumping out a ton of Vikings. Could this be a 3-1 here?
It could be. It really could be. Pulse is gearing up very nicely with his macro. He's 58 army supply to 55. Once these Colossi come out, there's going to be three
of
them.
He's going to see the move out. He has a single Marine.
Rain can't go. Rain surely can't go.
Oh, what is Pulse doing? He's to pull back. This is
Don't lose the medevacs.
He's going to lose a lot of units here, actually. This is pretty bad. But he knows this is coming, at least very early on. He has a single Marine out of each possible third base for Rain. So he knows he's going to have to pull a CV here. He's going to need some great positioning and micro.
All right. This army's pretty strong here from Rain. And
he could
the
actually
third
let base. That base die.
Yeah, he could. He could just abandon and try and run away. And that's going to be his go-to plan here. He's only got five Vikings to contend with this.
He's getting them 3x3. If he reaches like 10 or 11, he's going to have a much better chance at holding this. He's pulling the SCVs.
Uh-oh. It's a lot of Blink Stalkers here. So they could try and get under those Vikings, but there's not that many gateway units other than that to tank for these Colossi. So he has to be very, very careful about where he takes this engagement. And he sees it with the Observer. That's so important to know exactly where this army is.
And Rain's going to go for it here.
Oh my. He's actually going to go for this. Will he be able to do enough? He pulls on back with those force fields helping him out. A lot of that bio wasn't really doing anything. Left-hand side Blink trying to bring some of these Vikings down, but only one of the Colossi remains. It's not providing enough firepower here. He has to pull away. There's really not that many gateway units left on the ground. It's only Stalkers. Those a couple of extra Zealots try and move on in. One of those Colossi gets saved, but Pulse saves it. Pulse pushes on forwards. He's going to kill off that reinforcing pylon. The Colossus falls, and he's chasing away the Stalkers. It's 67 army supply to 41. This could be Pulse's game, Todd.
Yeah, Rain starts another Colossus behind this, but I don't think he's going to come out on time if Pulse attacks. Pulse is hesitant right now. He's lost his third command center. He's thinking about going for it, I think.
He lost a lot of workers as well.
Yeah, he lost a lot of workers. He's down to 30 SCVs against 52 probes, but he knows that Rain does not have that much tech. He knows that he has a Twilight for sure. He knows that he has 1-1. And you know what? Rain behind this, he starts charge. And I think he's going to want to turtle here a little bit and possibly go into a standard game.
Force fields are going to be the perfect answer to this if he can cut some of this off. He will buy some time. Two of those Marauders fall at the front here.
Oh.
And that bio can't do anything. Pulse feels as if he has to go.
Did you see that medivac? He kind of slapped it on the back and he died.
Okay, he somehow needs to find his way onto the high ground. This is the great thing about Yondu as a defensive position here for Rain. A lot of it is all chokes.
The Viking count is nil. There is no Viking out on the map right now, and no Viking in the production type. Second Colossus is on the way. Rain with some nice lead here with this attack, and he's even blocking that base with a pylon. Come on, man. This is not PvZ.
Well, it's going to work out for him quite nicely in the end if Pulse wants to try and expand again.
His Observer is so important here.
Did we spot the drops?
On the left side... Not yet, but he's about to, I think.
He's gonna,
Oh, actually, he might barely miss it. Is he gonna see it? Does he know? He sends a stalker.
He knows.
But is there enough? Yeah, there should be enough to snipe those medivacs. He sees it coming.
He should keep back. Keep back. Draw
and
him in.
And he's going to engage the main army at the same time.
Is he going to be able to blink? He gets one of the medivacs very, very quickly there. All of the units try to drop as best they can. Do force fields catch a little bit of the army too. Rain is up in terms of supply. He's keeping himself in this. He is doing so, so well despite the aggressive stance he took. He really put Pol in a very, very desperate situation. And now Pol is struggling to hold on here in game number four.
30 supply leads. Rain's crisis management. And by that, I mean mostly post all-in analysis and decision.
Yeah.
Really, really insane this game. Choosing to pull back, definitely the right choice. Did not commit anymore to the attack. Getting the Colossus, getting in perfect position, perfect micro against the follow-up attack. And Pot just doing the size. He wanted to go for the attack, but went for it too late. Didn't drop everything in the main. And again, these observers from Rain, getting him back in the game. Mm. When I thought he was quite far behind after this attack.
He sees everything. He's only got one observer left available to him though now. So maybe Polk can try and find an angle here with these medevacs. He only has one observer, but that pylon, no, it's not actually going to
see. This is going to get very, very scary here for Rain soon. His army is getting out of control. He has so many Colossus. He's actually moving. Oh, okay. He's left enough units back at home to defend against a big drop. And Polk, behind this, he's not going to commit everything to an attack. He's basically gone into Viking production and made a lot of SCVs. So as much as he could pull them, he could also go for another base. And I think if his main gets mined out, he just flies his command center somewhere else. The thing is, Rain has a huge lead. He started plus two, he has charge. He's going to get Archons in a second. Look at his guys.
He's set up nicely. Yeah, he can just warp in quite a lot of those. But at the same time, Pult's going to try and stim in. He realized that those Colossi were a little bit vulnerable. But he just gets pushed on back. There's too much damage that he's putting out. But those Vikings from the right-hand side here, trying to catch one of those Colossi. The Mothership Core soaks up a little bit of that damage. And this is just, I don't think it's going to go in the way of Pult here. I mean, his army's very, very split up. The Colossi are taking a bit of damage. But in the end, he's saving every single one of them.
Oh, wow.
Oh, what great control by Rain.
6 hit points and 50 hit points on this Colossi, and he might just counterattack here. Or not, because he's Rain after all. And he's about to have the third base. He starts Storm. He's like, you know what? There is no way with your current economy that you're going to be able to get Ghost. Even before, when you're on 3 bases, you didn't even manage to get them on a habitation station. So now on 2 bases, no chance. He knows that Pult is only trying to counter the Colossus now. Great decision to go for Storm.
Paul is in a scary spot here.
Look at his observer. He's on the third base now. He's always active.
He knows that his opponent is really, really suffering right now. And another observer to the left-hand side
he
is going to spot
the perfect time.
These medevacs. Paul has no way in. The drops could try and equalize things up, but feedbacks will push this away, and he's going to have no damage be done in the main. And, well, bye-bye. So,
get out of here.
Yeah, the extra Vikings, how many does he have right now? He's up to 3. He's only going to be up to 6 against this Colossus number. Even that isn't enough. Never mind the high Templars that are out, Todd. This is all looking a bit too bleak for our Terran here in game number 4.
You know, right? Rain is playing this so solid right now. He's making sure he doesn't throw the game away. He's playing it safe. He's making sure he has his composition again before he moves out. And oh, might be able to get to one of those medivacs. Yes, he is.
Yes, he does. And that poor little marauder falls off the cliff. So
there is Templars and cannons everywhere too now. In his third base, in his main.
It's just too hard to break him at this point. Rain has played this out great. Really, really great. And this looks like it might be a death march. As, well, he's going to try and pressure on once again.
Yeah, kill the rocks. Do it.
Oh, hello. This is us.
Is it?
Yes, this is us, unfortunately.
Not the best time, but...
I'm not sure why. Sorry about that, guys. Hashtag behave for me, I guess, but... we haven't done anything here. So, again, let's look at this from the bigger picture and the bigger perspective. I can actually just surrender and leave this, actually, because... Did you disconnect as well, actually? I think you may have done.
Yes.
If you click it as well, we can just go off the preview monitor, unless the entire system's gone down.
All right. We'll be finding out in a second what's happening here.
Yeah.
As Rain was actually about to attack that that third base, which is in fact the main orbital command that flew from the main. Again, Paul's really trying to salvage the situation as much as possible.
Yeah, this is quite the situation that we have on our hands, because right now it looks very, very seriously like it's going to be tied up 2-2 if Rain continues on the path that he's on, which means it comes down to one map after this. Of course, Polt's going to try and battle back in this fourth game.
Yeah.
He's going to try and drop on either side.
I think,
but it's too difficult. It's so
Rain
difficult.
Has so much. So Polt, what Polt's going to need is basically the best concave ever, and for Rain to mess up. And even then, he might be able to win because Colossus against not enough Vikings, even though there is quite a few out. Storm against no Ghosts. This should be too much, regardless. In that next attack.
And this has got to be a little bit frustrating for the players caught in this kind of trap that they find themselves in. It's not good to have these things happen, unfortunately, for these guys, as they are under a lot of stress at this point. So it can only add on to that. So they've got to keep calm in this situation. As Paul, he's probably slowly resigning himself to the fact that he's going to lose this game.
Yeah,
but he's going to battle tooth and nail. There's no reason for him to GG out super quickly. There's always a hope, always a chance that your opponent might mess up really catastrophically.
Rain here, definitely looking forward to that attack. Must be pretty confident he's going to be able to seal the deal in that game four, in which case they will go to a game number five. Man, we've had so many close series here.
We really have, and it just keeps going. But guys, we're gonna head over to Paul here whilst we have a little bit of this downtime.
Thanks very much, guys. Yeah, I'm with Apollo right now. I guess, you know, StarCraft's overwhelmed with all the amazing skills that we've got seen today and just can't cope anymore, but we'll get that fixed. Gives us a chance to have a bit of a natter about it. We've been watching the game in here, and I have to say the tension in here is quite high as it is, but the game's intense, and these two have just gone, they've just gone at it, hammer and tongs, no respect, nothing. They've just gone straight for each other.
Yeah, this has been so close. This series, I think a lot of people would agree that it was over. It was almost over. He held the all in, but then, I mean, there was so many decisions where he was like trying to be too aggressive, then was being too passive, didn't know how to finish the deal. Rain climbed back in because with the blink all in, you lose all your units, but he still has all his probes. So he's able to rebuild back up and get back into the game eventually with time, which is what we saw here. And then by trying to drop and all go all over the place, he's lost units. And it's actually looking like we're going to game five now.
Yeah, I mean, for a moment, it looked like, oh, hold on. We were convinced when we were like, oh, Polt's got this. He just attacks now and he's good. And then there was some indecision, which we haven't seen from him in any of his games so far this week. Suddenly he was like, shall I go? Shall I not go? Shall I drop? Shall I not drop? And then all of a sudden, five Colossus appear out of nowhere, and suddenly he's on the back foot.
He needed the killer instinct, I think. Once you hold that attack, the Protoss player, as mentioned, has no units, and he had so many himself, so you kind of just need to run for it. But, I mean, there was Violet, there was Leonard, we're all just kind of watching the games, and they were like, yeah, he's cautious, he doesn't want to lose the game from this point, but that was kind of what cost him the leading position anyway.
Do you think he should have pulled the boys and got stuck in and
absolutely.
Finished it off?
Well, maybe not pull the boys at that exact point, but he had to pull the boys at least once in this game to finish the deal. Kind of a reverse big attack like that definitely could have worked, but every Terran fan, every Port fan out there must be just screaming at the screen saying that this was almost one game.
2-1 right now to Polt, let's not forget that. So even if he ends up losing this one, we hopefully resume from replay, it's 2-2. We're back into a five-map game
And
again.
I think it's Altazim Stronghold, the last map, which
I think it is
no
too.
One wants to veto, but no one wants to play, so it's always the last map in the series.
Yeah. Difficult, isn't it? Because the first map, you looked at it and you went, oh, well, there's Rain.
Yeah.
17-1 in the last 3 months over Terrans. No problem. The only one map he lost was to Jack G, which was earlier today. And then wins the first map, so he's 18-1. You're like, well, how do you break this guy down? And then suddenly Polt's the first man to win two maps against him in 3 months.
Yeah, I mean, it was so crazy. I watched game number one, and I was like, Polt is playing like a god. But then what does that make Rain? Because he didn't lose and didn't look like he was ever going to lose. And I was like, all right, well, this series has gone one way, as many people expected. I think people believed in Polt, but after game one, it was like, I do believe in him, but it's still going to be really, really hard. But then in game two, he was able to deflect different types of all-ins that were coming his way, and he showed. I think there was one thing that stood out in the series the most, is that Rain came into the series saying, all right, I'll play normal, I'll do a blink all-in, I'll do a different type of aggressive play, but it got shut down. And I don't think Rain's comfortable in doing these types of builds. It's not his style. He's not meant to be that aggressive Protoss player. And then put on top that Polt's really good at playing against him. That only means to me, if we go to game five, which we should, is that it's going to be a big one.
Do you think there's absolutely no chance of Polt pulling this back? I mean, we've seen him come back already, and we've seen Jadon come back this weekend. So it's been a weekend of comebacks. Yeah. Is there one more in the bag here?
It's three base versus two for Protoss. It's five Colossus versus three Vikings. It's pretty ugly.
It is pretty horrible, I have to admit. The other thing I was going to talk to you about is we were talking about Blink All-Ins and the fact that Terrans in particular struggle with that, except if your name's Polt for some reason. And we reckon, still an estimate, but we reckon he's held off four out of five Blink All-Ins this week across all the games that he's played. That's really impressive.
That's super impressive. And just that stat alone, and I think that if Rain had a day... He'd probably beat what Paul's doing right now, but in a tense situation like this, he's not even going to worth risking it. He could sit there and be like, well, you know what? If he's going to do this, I could do this. It's not the time to try anything out. It's not practice. It's not training. This is the real deal. So,
I mean, we haven't seen it from either him or Classic. Well, Classic a little bit, but they're very passive kind of players. I mean, Classic, I don't even remember him scouting against Paul. So a bit better observer placement from Rain that we've seen in this last match. But other than that, it's almost like he's going, well, I can't blink all in because he's kind of good at that. So I'm more comfortable playing standard, so I'm just going to play standard.
And then,
of course, Polt goes, he's just going to play standard.
Take a third base. Yeah. And then Rain was like, all right, well, if you're going to take a third base, then I'll come and get you with my Colossus all in. So there's a lot of mind games and a lot of really high-level strategical play going on. And that's what's making the series so good.
Yeah, we've got our other semi-final to look forward to. We can just have a sneaky, quick preview of that while the players are getting ready for their drop-in via replay. Jadon made it through to the semi-finals. He's got one more game to go. It'd be heartbreak if he falls at this point before Katowice.
Yeah, the funny thing is, Jadon, I mean, obviously he's a little bit weak at the moment in this tournament. He's not playing his best. But against Hero has this thing where he gets really nervous against players he really respects. And I know he really, really respects Jadon. They used to be on the same team. And, you know, you could say that Hero was a dishwasher back then and Jadon was a legend, you know, who was sitting on piles of money and everything.
Make it sound like he was in the changing room before the game, polishing Jadon's boots.
Exactly. That's pretty much what it was. Well, polishing his mouse in this case,
yeah,
his keyboard. But that's the scale of these two players. And he really, really respects him. And I think, despite Jadon looking shaky, he may have a pretty good chance against Hero. And I really think that nerves can creep in that.
Okay, I think we're almost ready to go back. So let's go back to our commentary team now and get their collective thoughts as we get ready to go back in and resume from replay. Thank you for that option, Blizzard, as well.
Thanks very much, guys. All right, so we're recovering, getting back into game number four. We're recovering at a point where Polt is in a very tense moment as he knows he's on a significant back foot.
This was planned. We just wanted to show the cool countdown when... the game
I hope they show it. You better show it, guys. You better show it. And as you can see, we're just recovering there. There's Polt's screen as he gets himself psyched up for this game once again. But he may just realize that this is a little bit of a lost cause because of the spot that he's in. This is
has to be annoying, though, for both of them. Mm. But they're going to have time to refocus, of course. Assuming Rain wins here, there's going to be a very short break during fourth and fifth game.
Yeah.
And Rain here, you know, he needs to stay focused, actually. If he messes up here, Polt could hold. We've seen crazy holds. I don't think this is going to be possible here. Then again, I've been proven wrong before, especially when Jadon plays.
Oh, yeah. Well, okay, so we're about to finish up this recovery. It does take a little bit of time, but do bear with us, and we appreciate your patience out there, as these have been amazing games all day long. Just waiting a minute or two longer for even more amazing StarCraft action. It's not going to kill you. It's not. We're going to be okay, as right now he's looking at a pretty assured 2-2 position here, if he can just stay strong, stay focused. And then from there, we will be going on to a game five from there, then we would just see the go-to build guaranteed for these guys. There's no messing around in that game number five. Absolutely nothing. All right. The admin is asking if we are ready. Yes. And the players are ready as well. They are ready. So let's get right back into this. As Funker is ready too. 3, 2, 1. Let's go. Rain versus Polt still continues on, and Rain is actually pushing straight towards his third base here of Polt. I'm not sure, actually, Todd, how Polt can actually hold on
actually,
from this army.
He has 90 army supply against 112. This really is the storms that he has to be careful.
Oh, well, yeah, that storm hit pretty hard there. Blinks forwards as well, bringing down those Vikings. This could be the shortest recovery from replay from all time, as those storms also catch the rest of that bio. GG.
About 10 seconds worth of that game concludes.
Paul's
game
is probably like,
four.
What the hell are you guys making me do?
Oh,
well. I'm about to lose the game and you torture me. You're making me wait for those last few seconds of pain.
A little bit hard to avoid there in the end. But now, guys, let's wipe that out of our memories and say it is 2-2 between these guys who are fighting for absolutely everything in this tournament.
You know, I'm glad this did not happen in a situation where both players were, they had equal armies, and this was going to be the most important fight of the game. Like, we all knew what was going to happen here, even Paul. So,
yeah,
doesn't matter too much in the end. And going to a game number five here, these players, they're going to have to stay focused. They've been going head-to-head. It's now 2-2. Do we see again both of them going back to their go-to style, to their go-to build, Rain with the Colossus and Blink Play? I really like the initiative here. This is really what made him win, even though I was doubtful at first, just because of the way Polt, again, was trying to counter the Colossus play with the double starports, getting Vikings 3x3. It looked quite good for him, but then he made a lot of mistakes. He didn't kill the rocks between his natural and third base. His positioning was not great. He actually didn't have to... He could have been in a better position, you know? If he had spread his army across his ramp, above his ramp, basically in an arc, I'm not sure, concave, you can say concave, right?
Yeah, concave is
good. If he had basically set up a very good concave with the Vikings spread out as well, so that they would shoot if the Colossus are shooting at his bio forces, I don't think he would have lost. He was on two bases. He was getting way too many Vikings for the Colossus to be a drawable tech. And then he would have been able to re-expand. Rain was the one who attacked into port. And what you see very often when a player does an attack which is not about to work is the repositioning. So Rain attacked. He saw this was not going to happen if he had moved up the ramp. He pulled back and port chased him down. And at first it looked like a good idea. But then in the end, even though he killed a lot, he traded, and he ended up with basically 60 army supply against 40. Now he had a choice. Does he pull SCV and go for it, or does he wait? He waited, and Rain recovered.
Yeah, he recovered fantastically. And
I'm sorry if there was any plan to do any analysis on this game, because I just covered it.
Yeah. GG, guys. Sorry about that. But I realized, whilst you were saying all that, Todd, our last map is Ultrazine Stronghold.
Oh, my God.
Uh-oh. Well,
mass battlecruisers against mass tempest.
If there was ever a way to finish this series in fireworks, it's on Ultrazine Stronghold. This one could go on for a while, and all right, guys. It's one map to determine who moves on to the grand final, who moves on to the $100,000 tournament at Katowice. It's going to be either Rain or Polt. This is...
I want this series to never end.
No, it's good. It's
Let's
good.
Make it best of infinity.
We can like just sleep here as everything. My first two weeks of being actually in the ESL studios, I chilled out in the studio and slept here for a while, and I was like working back and forth. It was the best time ever. I was like, go downstairs, I'll get to work and do all the stuff, play some StarCraft. It was brilliant. So yeah, we could sleep here and just cast Rain versus Paul all day long. I'd be happy with that. That'd be fine by me. But for now, game number five. Now on the way here, Todd. Can you call it either way? Can you call it?
No, I can't.
No. There is no call here. Either of these players can win. It's 2-2. Let's get into Ultrazine Stronghold as we have spawning up to the top left-hand corner our SK Telecom T1 representative. It's Rain. Down to the bottom left, we have Captain America representing CM Storm. It's Polt.
Don't you find it funny that Polt's game tag is CM Storm and he actually kind of dread storms? He hates them.
Are you just realizing this, Todd? Or
no, because earlier, like, I think this was his tag was mentioned somehow just before a fight, and then he got stormed. And I was like, I just made the correlation somehow. I'm a little bit slow. Sorry.
I'm impressed by that. Well done, Todd. That was really quick. but for now, we will find out who is going to advance onto the grand final. Either of these players gracing us with their presence there is going to be great. I can't wait to see the final of this. I can't wait to see the next semi-final as well.
Yes.
Oh, it's going to be so good. Jadong versus Hero. One of those guys is going to be going up against either Paul or Rain. What a way to finish off this tournament. What a way.
And with so much on the line here, I expect them again to go back to their best builds, which I know I've said this was going to be the case in the last game, and it was true to some extent. And now we're getting to a point where both of these players, they can really start and anticipate very, very well what their opponent's going to do. Rain, he knew that third base was going to be thrown down very early before it even happened, just because it happened in the previous game, which he lost. And he countered it with some very, very nice move. Is it Paul's turn to completely anticipate what Rain's going to do? Which, to be honest, when he does open for the Colossus build, if he does not go for an all-in, it's going to be quite easy. You know he's going to go for a third. He's going to start 2-2 about the same time every single time. And does he try to punish that by some insane way? I guess you would have to call it, because not much has worked so far.
Well, we're going to find out in this next couple of moments as this game unfolds. The interesting thing about this, though, for Ultrazine Stronghold, for me, I feel that this map doesn't really work out that well for the style that Rain's been exhibiting. Notice how during all of these TVPs, he hasn't gone for a single Stargate. I really feel that Stargate's a good choice on this map, but Rain hasn't really done it too much.
The tricky part, if he goes for Blink and Colossus, is going to be defending between his third base and main base, especially on those positions. The positions are very interesting here. If he's getting dropped, he's going to have Stalkers in position. Then again, he has a lot less space to cover than on some other maps, as far as observers go. Imagine he puts a line from left to right of observers just below his natural. Mm. He's going to see so much. He's going to be able to see, again, anything that's headed his way. So I know, again, this is a lot of theory crafting and we are not there yet, but if this was to happen, Rain again, as much as it could be hard for him to defend, there is also a few good points to those positions and the way he could exploit the map to his advantage.
Well, this Reaper is doing its best to have a look around and jump back on in later on. It already got the confirmation of that Nexus going down. And we actually have Paul mixing things up.
Yes.
He's going to go for the factory this time.
And it's good because I think his three barrack style is good on Watchtower's map.
Yeah.
Just because he likes to counter Blink this way. And on this map, not only Blink is not great, but you have a very small ramp at your opponent's entrance. And you're not going to be able to do much. Sometimes somebody is going to make a sentry. You're going to find yourself trapped if you get in there too early.
You're 100% right.
And you need to go through the main with Bioforces to go to natural before Medivacs too.
So having Medivacs out earlier on this map is always going to be the better option if we look at it like that, unless your opponent's doing something really weird. But Rain is going to opt for the Robo Facility once again. And this is going to play out normally here.
All right. Quick starport. I really feel like as much as this opener is nice from Terran, the one guy that handles it the best so far has been Rain every single time. Even though we've seen him sometimes not reacting very, very quickly to some Widowmine drops and losing some probes here and there, he usually defends well enough to make sure he pulls ahead or actually survives until he has the strong army that he likes to get.
I really hope we see both of them just continue on with this macro play, because then if we have a big, huge, grand macro game to finish this best of five off, it really is the cherry on top of the cake here, as Mr. Apollo would have elaborated to earlier. Bye-bye, probe.
Apollonius cakes.
All right, well, the engineering bay has started up for Mr. Paul as well, so I don't think he's going to throw down a missile turret or anything. I don't think he feels that threatened.
Actually, I was gonna say he might be afraid of some kind of Dark Templar drop again on a map like this.
The front or something.
We're going to see in a second. If he starts plus one and doesn't get a turret, I guess you'll have been right. And plus one still does not start. He's spending gas elsewhere. Getting a very, very quick medivac here, obviously going to be the priority. And I love how he's done this with the add-ons too, building one of those barracks on a reactor. Mm-hmm. This is pretty cool. You see he's getting the tech lab on the factory. This is going to be for the barracks, I'm expecting. Probably not going to see a Banshee here.
No, that would be a bit little weird here from Paul, because we haven't seen that too yet. And whoa, Templar Archives. And he sees it. He sees it, Todd. That's really quick compared to what we were usually seeing here from Rain.
Did he have time to click on it?
Yes. Yes, he saw it. Oh, he saw it. He definitely saw it.
Yeah, this is pretty cool. You know what? Paul has been taking very, very late to Ghost in a lot of his games. So even though he's played very well and solid overall in most games, I would like to see a very quick Ghost Academy in this game. And again,
this Warp Prism is very quick.
8 minutes third base here for Paul. And Widowmine on the third here. This is super cool.
I've got to say, I guess the Templar Archives is good here against kind of drop play if you can have high Templars in positions to feedback whenever they would want to come in. But he starts Storm very fast anyway, so this is going to be good for him. The Warp Prism's already out and about.
Yeah, and we've really seen classic Make Magic with this Warp Prism and two Templars in it and Storm. And I think this is what it's going to be here.
Yeah.
Super fast two Templar Storm drop. This is insane. This is going to arrive so fast. At like 10 minutes 30? You don't really expect this to come. You're not. Pulsestone's going to have turret in his natural. I assume this is going to be dropped in the natural.
You know, this is going around such a long way. Yeah. Such a long way that this will arrive just as Storm finishes.
Yeah, maybe not 10:30.
This is crazy. at least that reveals that there is a Widowmine down there. And he does spot it with the Observer in the end anyway. So he can clean that up and eventually claim his third base. But Paul's going to try and keep eyes on that for as long as possible.
Paul's going to have to react very, very quickly. I'm actually going to focus on his view when this is about to happen to see how he handles that. Plus two armors on the way here for rain. And look at how many cannons he's making in his natural.
Yeah.
He wants to make sure he doesn't die there. This is basically the weak points of Protoss versus Terran on this map. If you get dropped here, a lot of the time it's going to be super hard to defend. And Rain's not going to have any of it.
Especially in these spawning positions, which technically for Polt right now are working in his favor because of how accessible that natural is. There's a Widowmine down in the natural. Very, very eagerly placed. This Warp Prism's going to die, Todd. It's actually going to die.
Oh, it doesn't die in one hit, Widowmine.
Oh,
hit.
Yeah, it actually goes down to health.
James.
You're right. No, you're right. Okay, I'm over-anticipating.
And a cancel on the third base here, nicely done by Polt. So he has to know something's up right now. All right, I'm going to focus on his view. I want to see how quickly he reacts to this. Oh, he's actually sent something over there just now. Maybe, is it some units or a Viking? Oh, he's sending a Viking, but this is too far away.
Yeah. Oh, Stormanu!
Only two SCVs died?
Yeah, he pulled so quickly.
No, only one SCV died.
Whoa.
Are you kidding me?
All right, Pulse on fire, man.
And the War Prism died with the two Templars in it. The Viking caught it.
Oh, my.
As much as the weirdo mind got you all excited, this is actually the Viking that he had to be worried about.
Good job, Viking. Good job. Well done.
Polt with an insane lead now. He's on 63 SCVs across three bases, against 61 probes. Yeah. Third base just started for rain.
I can't believe how little the Storms actually did. Polt's reactions here in game number five are key. They're on point. He has an extra engineering bay. He can start plus two weapons if he wants to. He's adding on extra production facilities, getting more barracks. There's another War Prism on the way for rain, but...
He's getting a Sensor Tower and no Ghost Academy. I'm really afraid that he goes again into very passive mode. There's the Ghost Academy.
Okay.
There's the Ghost Academy that he needs.
And he has to be Rain has to be careful at the front here because this army that we're seeing from Polt's quite strong, but the High Templars are holding him at bay for now. That's the one linchpin that Rain has to the defense of this third base.
Rain is so scared for his natural. Four cannons and two Templars now?
He should be scared of it. Look at these three medevacs heading over in that direction.
Yeah, but surely Paul's going to scan and make sure he doesn't drop there, which I guess Rain kind of wants to. He just doesn't want to be attacked there.
They don't really have that much energy, so feedback isn't going to do a huge amount to them. But he's already warping in some units. They've been seen by observers.
Whoa, this could be boosted in the main.
Well, the feedback's hit, and there's probably enough units here to be able to push this away. So those zealots are wisely positioned. Storm will hit. He also storms on the right-hand side as well here. But Paul's going to be pushing in from three angles on this third base, trying to do as much damage as he can. Meanwhile, Storm drops here on a lot of those SCVs in the main, and Pulse reaction time is not quite as good at this point. Rain is taking a little bit of a supply advantage. Storm will push that away as well. Not too bad here from Rain. Certainly a fantastic defense, as a fantastic offense. As he warps in a few units, will have to sacrifice these, but the Warp Prism gets away.
For how long? There is a Viking not too far. The one hero Viking could possibly get two Warp Prism each with two Templars in. He's going across there.
MVP Viking.
Big mistake here by Pulse, not to put any turret on this corner of his base. After there was a... that Warp Prism. Goodbye.
He did get one in the end.
Yeah.
Wait, was it the missile turret or...?
You know, Rain killed quite a few SCVs there. Ten in total. But as I was saying, Polt not getting any turret on the left-hand side of his main base. Big mistake. Rain went for the early on Warp Prism drop with two Templars. Didn't do any damage. A lot of the time, he's still going to try for more. And big Colossus transition out of him, which Polt's definitely not going to... Polt's finally getting the Ghost, as I wished, but now he has no idea that the Colossus are coming, so he's going to need to be aggressive. He's going to need to figure out what he's up against, and he needs to keep on applying pressure against a Rain that's so good at defending.
And the incomes are sitting pretty for both players here. They're around the 2,000 mark for both of them here. As if he can get this Colossus transition up and running, super powerful, then this is going to be hard for Polt to really deal with. He's getting personal cloaking. How many observers? He still has three out and around.
I always feel weird when personal cloaking start. I was like, why not Mobius Reactor? Then I realized.
Yeah, something
actually
changed, Todd.
Rain's going for a timing before there's too many ghosts.
That's a lot of storms there for just a small portion of bio that poked on forwards, and he has to be careful because up on the high ground to the left, there is that extra bio, but it's sat in range just barely of that observer. This is a big army, though. Not too bad force fields. We'll seal this away for just a second. He has to pull on back, though, as it was counteracting the zealot movement.
I don't think that Paul should be fighting without his ghosts at this point, and it looks like he wants to go into turtle mode, man. He's getting another command center, which looks like it's in a position where he might PF it. Could take that left-hand side base as well. And going for the 2-2 himself, whereas Rain is already on level 3 ground armor.
Ooh.
He's getting blink now. Rain's transition here. If Paul gives him enough time and Rain gets, say, like 4 or 6 Colossus, he's getting blink with this.
Yeah.
To even cover against the Vikings that are not even here.
That's good. That's very, very good foresight here by Rain. But at the same time, he hasn't really been able to spot that drop heading up to the top right. I think he may... Wait, where is that observer? Okay, it's a zealot, actually. So no, he hasn't spotted these four medevacs. And there is a poke at the front, as he will have to pull away for a second. But
there's only three ghosts in this army, by the way.
Yeah, Pulse now maxed out. And he's going to drop these four medevacs right into the main. There's really not a whole lot to deal with that one photon on cannon and the photon overcharge as well, but he couldn't really warp in either because he was almost maxed out at this point. That's a lot of damage being done. Also being pressured at the front here. This is a really good opportunity for Paul to move on forwards. He actually landed a great EMP on two of those High Templars.
Yeah, the ghost came in from the side here.
Uh-oh, Rain's down in terms of supply, Todd. He's down very much in terms of supply. Is Paul going to be able to power on through? He's still doing damage in the main. His army supply is 120 to 87 now. As Paul is
going to
get the Nexus. He gets the Nexus. There's not a whole lot of money there. But if he can get that one, that's going to be huge. He gets that. The third Nexus will end up falling. Paul retreats out. A victory here so far for Paul, who is looking in prime position to claim this fifth game.
Oh my God, Paul, that was so good. He found the one place he could drop through where there was going to be no observer. He finally found a weakness in Rain's defense.
He finally did, and Rain now is reeling from it. His income is slightly waning compared to his opponents,
by
but he'll be able to get it going because of this drop.
We had one Archon here and one Templar. The Archon had about 14 kills and the Templar 11. So a lot of SCVs died.
Yeah.
But this is actually going to help Paul because he's down to 60 SCVs and he has a lot of orbital commands. He's going to be able to use a lot of mules and basically maxed out on pure army. 140 army supply is what he can make right now.
And during all of that, we didn't notice that that was that War Prism going around the bottom hand side for that harassment, which was fantastic by Rain, but he was always distracted during this. The drop once again from Paul is going to keep Rain pinned back.
But Skylar, I'm really afraid. We have only 8 Vikings for 5 Colossus. The thing is, Paul is using the lack of mobility of this army and the mobility of his own medivacs to drop all over the place.
Yeah.
He might be attacking a little bit too early here. If he gets his army crushed, he lets Rain get back into the game.
And he only has plus 1
weapons.
Oh, he gets
a cancel.
Yeah, that was really nice.
And I don't
really
think Rain realized that there is this few Vikings, otherwise he would definitely engage.
Yeah, it's only got plus 1 weapons on those Vikings as well. The one thing I'm scared of is if all of the observers die. Nice denial there of that push on forwards. He gets one of the observers above him. How many does he have left? He has 3. Because right now with those ghosts,
where are they?
I'm always scared of personal cloaking.
Two
the
of
three?
Them are above the army. One of them is actually out of position on the top.
He was
following the
medivacs,
I guess.
Exactly. And he starts plus 2 weapons. Well, he started plus 2 weapons a while ago for these Vikings. But that's very important as he climbs up in that Viking count. He knows he can't engage just yet, but he's about to max out.
Hello, Mr. Raven. We have a single Raven out on the map.
Oh, yeah.
Which actually reminds me of that one game that Paul lost, the very long one. So
I think PDD is a great choice against opponent blinking forwards with Stalkers to try and couch out those Vikings. But at the same time, the storms are the big thing that's actually going to rip those Vikings out of the sky if he's not careful. So,
Fault is actually on 8 barracks. He's going to start to get quite a bank here.
Yeah.
Definitely should start adding a little bit more. Both players are almost fully upgraded here. Paul's about to get 3-3 here with the level 3 armor, and the sheep weapons level 2 really going to help too.
Going to try and drop in there. He did get one of the feedbacks on that medevac with maximum energy, so that was a good pickup there by Rain. But at the same time, this drop is going to really power down a lot of those probes. He might even start targeting the Nexus down. Photon overcharge is activated. He can't necessarily evacuate out with all of this, but he brings the Nexus down, denying a little bit of mining here from Rain. But during all of this, he got his fourth base up to the top right-hand corner, which is phenomenal.
phenomenal control and phenomenal pacing.
Whoa,
here.
What is this doing there? He's trying to get against the Nexus.
Oh, and he might be able to get at those Vikings of zoning Matt. He has plus two weapons on them. The storm lands at them. A great blink forwards though by Rain, who takes a supply advantage for a second, but he still did deny the third base.
Rain's gonna counter. He's gonna counter. He's had enough. He's got all of his next eye sniped, and this is enough for him. He's killing a lot of those Vikings here. Six Vikings against four Colossi.
And Paul, all this while, didn't know about the fourth base that was up to the top right-hand corner. He still has no vision of it. How can he not see that this is where all of this is being fueled from by Rain? This is going to be difficult for Paul. The army supplies...
Oh, dropping the main, snaps the Robo.
Oh, if he can get that. Well, he got both of them in the end.
He got both of them. So no more Colossus production. If he kills this Colossi, Paul's going to be in a great position to possibly win. He has a lot of ghosts, but not any Vikings in comparison to this Colossus count.
He has eight Vikings. Can they do the damage they need to? That's a lot of High Templars behind it as well. The engagement for Paul is going to have to work in tandem so well with one another. Every single aspect is going to have to line up for Paul.
Look at the production tabs. Paul is getting so much more units right now. He needs to hold on.
He's going
to
go for it. He drops a big, big storm on a lot of those ghosts. They are being zoned out by those zealots. He has to pull on back now for just a second. Another storm on the Vikings, though. Paul with a supply advantage. His army is actually bigger here than Reigns. Will he be able to power on through? That's a lot of bio. He stiffs it back.
The Observer dies. Two more Observer join the fight.
There's nothing to deal with the Vikings. The Vikings are going to town on the Colossi. Rain is going to die off here. Paul is going to be victorious. 90 army supply against 17. Oh my god, what are we seeing? Rain has economy behind this, and it's so dead even once again. But Pult now, if he goes, if he has that killer instinct that we saw Apollo talking about during that break, he could end this right now. But he's being patient about it.
Yeah.
Load up, go. Go, Pult.
He's going to go for some kind of attack. He knows he's ahead economically still, even though he doesn't have all that many bases compared to what he could have. He has a bunch of command center. I'm sure he's going to start flying one over to the left-hand side very, very soon. It looks like he might want to drop that natural very, very soon again, which, by the way, I'm quite surprised it got broken. Four cannons plus Templars.
Yeah.
Pult didn't care. He went in there, he dropped, he sniped everything. And Rain still has a quite good economy, as much as I thought this was going to be it for Pult here. He's taking his time, and he's actually now moving across the map. The ghost count right now, only one against five Templars.
Uh-oh.
And most of them have Storm. This is still a very tight situation that he's in.
This drop on the left-hand side now. Pult is basically constricting Rain as best he possibly can do. It's 108 army supply against 70.
Templar guy goes down. And he's going to go for an attack in that fourth base. There is a lot of zealots and cannons.
He finally
has to be careful.
He finally finds this base that has been the lifeblood of Rain, really keeping him alive, and he has to boost away.
Yeah.
But knowing that this is here now is really important for Pult to pressure on and continue the pace of this game. He kills off the Robo Bay. No more Colossi. No more Templar. Not even the Twilight Council. So he's going to have such a hard time transitioning, even if he wanted to, back to the tech that he's lost.
He just broke the entire tech of his opponents. Rain's going to be stuck on 3-2 upgrades. He could get shield level 1, but that's not really going to do much. He cannot even, I guess, spare it right now. What you want to be adding as Rain here is Colossus. He has remade a single Robo on his natural, which is getting a War Prism right now. And I think Rain, to get back in this, is going to try to do some harassment with some Templars, some Zealots. But actually, I don't even think he can spare some Templars for harassment. He has five of them. He cannot even remake any right now. He's remaking a Twilight Council, Pult. If he goes for a follow-up attack here very, very soon, he should be able to end the game. He's getting three ghosts.
He should. It's double an army supply right now. Double the army supply, Todd.
Ooh, he's preparing for a big attack in the main here. We have two Templars in position. I don't know. They can do a lot of damage, but they're going to die right behind this.
There goes the Stim, and he should be alerted to the presence of this. But divides up the units, tries to bring down the High Templar. One of them ends up falling.
So on the right-hand side, too.
And meanwhile, right on that right-hand side, this is a perfect opportunity for Paul Seeley. GG! I don't believe it! Paul, after five games, is victorious! He moves on to the grand final. What a series! He is absolutely ecstatic here in Cologne. I am so blown over. That was, what a series, Todd. What a series.
What a series indeed. Rain definitely looking a little bit sad here, but Pult, what a hero, man. He played this so well from start to finish. You know, when I saw that natural expansion with the four cannons and two Templars, I was thinking, if there is a base that's never going to be broken, it has to be this one. But Pult, I think the turning point, actually, of this game, is there going to be analysis? For me, I'm still going to say it anyway. For me, was this big medivac drop coming from the top right-hand side. Because, as I say, of course he was going to cover that space between Pult's main and his own base, which a lot of observers, but never really do you put an observer on the top right-hand side to see any drop coming from this way. So Pult went all the way around, He was at the very border of the map. He dropped in the main. From that time where he sniped the Forges, almost got the Nexus, Rain started falling apart. And it was very frustrating situation too for Rain, because he kept on getting stuff sniped, and every time he was thinking about counterattacking, but he couldn't really, because it would be committing to an attack. Then when he finally did, Polt held.
All right. Well, guys, that does it from us here at the first match of the round of four, and there is no more to say here. Let's hear from the person advancing onto the grand final, CM Storm Polt.
Ladies and gentlemen, CM Storm Polt is your first grand finalist for the Intel Extreme Masters in Cologne. And more importantly for this man, I know he's really excited about it, he qualifies for the World Championships in Katowice. How are you doing right now?
I don't know what to say. I'm so happy right now.
You came over and you said, I beat the Protoss.
Protoss, actually, it's so OP. Everyone.
No. Protoss, easy now.
It's easy just for me.
Okay. I'm going to do something that I've never done before, okay? As a British citizen, right, I'm going to knight you. You are now, by the power invested in me, Sir Polt of Terran. Who do you want in the final? Silly question, because I reckon I already know the answer.
Of course, no more Protoss. I want Tadon.
Ladies and gentlemen, CM Storm Polt is your first finalist of the weekend.